Hey, everybody. It's June 19th, 2019, and coming to you from the Troily Design Saloon in Corona, California. It's the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for tuning in. We've got a cool show today. We've got 7-time Supercross winner, 2-time X Game gold medalist, and just a real cool guy, Josh Hansen, is in here with us today. A little Hanny. GL and I have known him for quite a while, both of us, so this should be a fun show. Speaking of GL, my man, Grant Langston here, co-hosting with me as always. How we doing, bud?
Good. How about yourself?
Ready to do it? I'm good. A little tired. We got coffee rolling. Well, I do.
I'm glad you do. I couldn't find any.
I'll get better as the show goes on. You always keep going bull.
Yeah. No, great to have Hanny on. Obviously, like you said, someone we've known. And when he left his home in Colorado and was just this young, single, crazy kid, he ended up being my roommate. And, wow, there's some stories there, too. Hanny was quite the character, I'll tell you that.
Well, that's it, right? He's a character. I know he was reluctant to come on because he felt like, my story's not worth having. You know, we're going to ask him about that. And I'm like, what are you talking about, man? Your story, it may not have ended with a bunch of championships, but it's been a wild career for him and just a pretty crazy life, I would say.
Well, Hanny was one of those guys, he's got so much natural talent that whatever he kind of put his mind to, he did very well at. And so I think sometimes he feels he should have achieved more. And I think a lot of times we may all, as racers, feel that way to an extent. But I love Hanny. I'm looking forward to hearing his side of the stories.
Yeah, it'll be a lot of fun. Over here in the corner, we got our producer, Donnie Bales. Donnie, how we doing, bud?
Doing good, man.
You ready? You knee healing up? You ready to do this?
Yeah, actually doing good.
All right.
I don't need a cup of coffee.
You don't drink coffee?
No, I've never had a cup in my life.
That's crazy.
I've never drank a cup.
Why?
Because it smells like shit.
Really?
Yeah.
You know what's funny is when I was younger, my dad would drink coffee every morning. I loved the smell of coffee, but I didn't like the taste of it.
Same.
So it took a while to acquire it. But now, when you travel through the airports and all that, and they're fresh brewing coffee, I love the smell of coffee. I like the smell more than even the taste.
Yeah.
But I just douse mine with like flavored creamer and all this. It's
so
like a milkshake by the time
I'm done.
So I say
just get
caffeinated milkshake.
Just get rid of the coffee and put the milkshake in.
Yeah. All right.
Listen, if I even smell the beans, it kind of makes me gag.
Really?
Yeah. I can't stand it.
Sounds like maybe there's a backstory to this.
Yeah.
My dad would
something
drink.
Bad happened as a
my
boy.
Dad would,
do you have a bad gag reflex or something?
My dad would drink it 5-6 times a day, and it doesn't matter if it's 100 degrees out or if it wasn't, and I just couldn't stand it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's a
well. We got that out of the way.
Problem. Yeah. Everybody's glad to know all that.
Yeah. Well, you know.
Josh Hansen's brought to you today by PowerDot. If you haven't checked out PowerDot, go to PowerDot.com. Amazing unit for anybody, not just athletes, but sedentary folks, anyone. It's got great massage features. It's great for warm-up recovery, injury prevention, injury maintenance, injury rehabilitation. Awesome product. And type in Whiskey Throttle at checkout. I've got some people that get this sideways. They put Whiskey Throttle Show. They put a space. They do all kinds of stupid stuff. Just Whiskey Throttle, one word, no capitals, no show, Whiskey Throttle. 20% off. Also, Method Race Wheels, big supporter of this show. We love their stuff. Check out methodracewheels.com. Just simply the best wheels for any kind of off-road application. Trucks, sprinters, UTVs, they make rad stuff. Not only does it work really well, it's really cool-looking stuff. Decal Works, big fan of those guys. They've supported us with a lot of stuff. They've got some new graphics coming out. You can order Whiskey Throttle Show graphics. I've got some of those I just made for a Yamaha. We'll be running at Redbud for the 125 All-Stars race. You can check those out. But hit them up. Say, hey, you want some Whiskey Throttle graphics? They will build them for you. Four Wheel Parts, they're bringing you the Q&A today. Love those guys over at Four Wheel Parts. Awesome dudes. Troily Designs, if you haven't purchased your Freedom Pack, you got to do it. 4th of July is coming up, and Troily Designs got you covered. Adidas.
Don't be a dick to your feet.
Don't do it.
Don't do it.
Good shoes. Pro Circuit, also a big supporter of this show. We appreciate Mitch Payton and the boys over there. Simply the best exhaust systems, engine performance, suspension, two-stroke stuff.
Even had a chance to chat with him at the hotel after the race, and we were laughing and talking about how many stories weren't told at Troy Stories. So
Oh boy.
I think we need to have a part two to that one.
We could. Oh, we just need to have each of them on. I think more stories will come out when they have their own shows, which we're planning on doing. I've had a lot of people say, I can't believe you had them on, but then, you know, you didn't get into their whole story. It's like, calm down. Troy's going to have his own show. Mitch will have his own show. That was a special thing for the distributors meeting we had. Dunlop Tires also. Big thank you to Dunlop. First of all, every single championship in the United States for the last how many years has been won on Dunlops. So the performance is obviously there. There's no other brand that puts in the effort to support the riders on a professional level, on an amateur level. And if nothing else, performance aside, they support this sport from the grassroots level to the professional level. Dunlop is in it 100%. And I'm a big believer in supporting people who support the sport. No other tire manufacturer, they all have pulled out of Supercross and Motocross.
Well,
like mostly all the way. So
well, I did a great job at Paula.
Pulling out is good sometimes, not when it comes to supporting our sport. So support the companies that have this sport's back, and that is Dunlop.
So I have to correct something. I kind of put my foot in my mouth at Paula when Ben LeMay had his moose come out of his. I'm like, wow, haven't seen that before. And I don't know why. I just assumed he was on Dunlop. I just said, man, we've got to ask the Dunlop guys if they've seen it. And then I get a message from Brock Glover. He's on Pirelli. So I was like, whoops.
Well, there you have it. Pirelli's blowout, I guess. I don't know what happened. What did happen with that? I saw the pictures of it.
Yeah, I don't know. I heard that he runs this kind of weird step lip, and it was a last-minute change. And Doug, who used to be at Bridgestone, is now at Pirelli, and I think he had to do a last-minute rush job, and it just sounded like it was one of those things.
Just but a fluke
it's,
deal.
It's happened a couple times because after Brock corrected me, he also said, oh, and by the way, we have seen this a couple times. I guess it happened at Donations to one of the French riders. I'm trying to remember now. And he said it's very, very rare, but it's happened to them once or twice. But that time around, it was Pirelli. So,
All right. Well, anyway, Dunlop tires, check them out. We're going to be giving away a free set at our live Red Bud show. So if you're going to Red Bud, the stipulation is we're going to find someone in the crowd wearing a Whiskey Throttle t-shirt. You got a Whiskey Throttle t-shirt? You got a chance to win a set of Dunlop tires. So pick your stuff up now. Nihilo Concepts, these guys are a new sponsor to the show. We absolutely love their products. I use their foot pegs on a lot of our project builds. We use their frame protectors on a lot of our builds. Their stuff is really cool.
Follow them on Instagram. They show you all their new cool stuff that they're working on at the moment. So
yeah, that's right. And they've got
a very innovative sort of company.
They are, and they're growing. They're expanding. They really started in KTM Husky, and they make a lot of parts for the race team that people don't really realize that, but they do. You'll see all the Nihilo foot pegs, billet titanium pegs on the factory KTM and Husky race teams, but they're making more parts. They've got a new billet throttle housing. Those stock throttle housings in a crash can bend.
They can break.
And break and cause some problems, obviously. So they built a much stronger, much better unit. You can check those out. Thanks to Specialized Bicycles as well. They've come on recently. We absolutely love those bikes.
And I've put the bike to the test.
Yeah, Shale's already broken his, smashed it into a rock, broke the chain. Actually, Troy broke the chain.
Yeah, technically Troy did break the chain, but I set him up.
The one thing they tell us, okay, now don't, if you're pedaling and the engine's engaged, you're going up a hill, don't be grabbing a bunch of gears because if there's a lot of torque on that chain, you'll break chains. So Troy takes off on your bike. Let me see this.
And well, because I was having some issues. But that's because I went off the main line and went into a ditch, framed my bike, cartwheeled. I still have some road rash and a couple bruises, but I had a good chuckle to myself. I felt more bad about the bike, but apparently it wasn't really that bad. There was one little piece that got disconnected, but we're
so
all good to go.
So he figured out what it was. All right.
Yes. Thanks, Curtis.
I was pretty impressed with Troy's riding, huh?
Like, dude, he's a madman.
Yeah.
We're going down those hills. I'm not going to lie. I was out of my league. I forgot you could drop the post. I was thinking I was going over the bars, and you guys were just taking off. And then eventually I was like, you know what? I'm going to be that guy. I unclipped and just went down like I was skiing, just like a real goon. But he is mental. I'm telling you, that guy has not slowed down one bit.
Not one bit. Yeah, we did a ride in Laguna Beach, and he took us down some pretty steep downhill.
And what's funny is you talk to mountain bike people, that they don't know those trails. They're like, aren't those hiking trails? I'm like, either way, they're sketchy trails.
Yeah. I don't think they're even on the map. That's what Troy said. Anyway, big thanks to Specialized. Awesome products. If you're in the market for a bicycle, again, they're hands down the best bicycle. Ask anybody who's not biased what the best brand is. They will tell you Specialized. Big thanks to RacerX as well. Get over to RacerX online and subscribe to their digital and print editions. Awesome stuff. You get stuff in the magazine you don't see on the web, and vice versa. The web is more results-based, a lot of current event stuff, topical stuff, where the magazine is more cool features, historical stuff, columns. So they just complement each other really well. Let's jump into our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter. Method Race Wheels bringing you the toughest, lightest, fastest wheels in off-road. And they also keep your truck looking sweet, your Sprinter van from looking like an Amazon delivery truck, which I think is important, unless you're actually delivering packages for Amazon.
But then throw methods on anyway. He'll be the coolest guy in town.
Be the dopest delivery boy in town.
It changed, I tell you what, it changed the look of my Sprinter completely.
Your Sprinter looks good now.
And that's what we did was wheels and tires. And with those all-terrain tires, man, it's... My dad goes, why'd you put all-terrain tires on? I'm like, I don't know if you know, Dad, but I actually go on all-terrain. So, you know, when we go to the riverbeds and stuff, when we go ride or our little secret spot where you got to get through the sand.
Yeah. Dialed. Yeah, you don't want to get stuck. So a couple things I thought we needed to talk about. First of all, this 450 chase in the Outdoor National Series, man, it's going to be a nail-biter. I kind of, usually by this point, there's a guy that separated himself.
Yeah.
And it just hasn't happened yet. It's definitely coming down to two guys, Ken Roczen and Eli Tomac. But so far, I would say neither one of them has really asserted themselves as the man.
For sure. And even that, you could say, yes, it's a two-horse race at this point, but it's not going to be easy, and it's not just going to be the two of them. You know, in years gone past, you might have seen like Ricky and James out in front, and there was only going to be – they were either going to be first or second.
Right.
It's not like that at the moment. You got Anderson, who's riding well. Baggett's kind of finding some form. Cooper's figuring it out. Marv is up there. He just had a little bit of bad luck on the weekend, but his speed is there. So, I don't know if I said Osborne, but, you know, anyway, there's five other guys that can beat these guys on given weekends. So, you can't afford that first turn crash with the big mistakes because there will be riders to separate you. And I think it's been really good. And anyone watched the racing on the weekend, I mean, it was some good stuff. And even at times, still a little unpredictable. Who would have guessed Blake Baggett would have ran away first moto, you know? So I like that unpredictability of the class. But at the same time, when you talk big picture championship, I think it's going to come down to those two. Unless someone just, maybe someone like Cooper Webb or someone can catch fire and rack off some unbelievable results. But on the flip side, we've seen Tomac win nationals by a minute and a half. That's not happening at the moment. Everyone's...
What do you think that is?
I mean, I think everyone else is going faster.
I mean, you know, uncharacteristically, he isn't dominating every race right now.
I think that the guys... I think Alden's guys have picked up their pace, maybe pushing each other. And with Kenny getting stronger and healthier, I think that gap's just done that. And that keeps the pressure on everyone. Yeah. So...
The neat thing to me is, it's like you said, there are those five or six guys who are going to get in there and steal wins, and they're going to mix up the points big time. Mm-hmm. So the pressure's on those two title contenders.
To be consistent.
To be consistent. You've got to get starts. You can't have a big crash. You can't do what Marvin did, go down on that first lap. You will not be back on the
Has Marvin fallen at every single round?
Yes.
He's fallen at every
round. I think at every round he's gone down the first lap one moto.
Yeah.
Kind of unlucky stuff, though. It's not like he's having...
Barsha gave him a little nudge at Colorado.
He'll do that from time to time.
Yeah. but on the weekend, he just ran into the back of Baggett. So at the same time, you can say some bad luck, but it's kind of like, hey, Marv, that was on you, bud.
Yeah.
Hey, let me ask you this. How does Roczen in the first moto go from basically kind of fourth and then work his way back to sixth? And then in the second moto, just go out and destroy him. How does that happen?
He said he made some bike changes, but...
Can you make bike changes that much?
That's the thing that I don't get. You know, okay, it sounds like he made a guess at what their setting should be, and he said for the second moto, they went back to their base setting.
That track was tough. Like, even when we did our wrap-up at the end of the day where we go and do our little NBC closing, I was looking off the finish line. I even turned around, I'm like, holy crap. The ruts were gnarly. Mm. I mean, they were the outsides of some of the ones on the off camber. They had to be almost like to your hip in some spots. No joke. Like, you had to be leant over, otherwise you would hit the wall. So the track was, once again, I don't think they ripped it as much as they have in the past. And with that kind of more clay dirt out there, it was very choppy. You watch the bikes, they were dancing around a lot. And I think a lot of riders were kind of second-guessing their setup once they got there. So,
well, and I think Ken shines. The more technical a track gets, he's so freaking smooth and technical.
But I think sometimes
as it gets
deep,
that's
how he can
bumps.
Have two different motos. Yeah. If the bike's not doing what he wants, I think for him it's hard to be that smooth Ken Roczen that goes fast, you know, efficient. Because second motor, you watch it and you go, it didn't look much different. Meaning, like, when the camera's on him, it doesn't look much different, but he'll be like, oh yeah, the bike wasn't working first motor, much better second motor. And you're like, really? I didn't see that. You know what I mean? You don't visibly see it, but he feels it. And obviously that's...
From the other rounds, we haven't seen him go backwards at all, except for in that first moto, which he was almost into third at some point. And then he went back to six. Then it's like, how does that even happen?
Yeah.
Well, that's what I said. The depth is there. And if you're off a little bit, just a couple percent, that's going to happen.
It's pretty amazing that we don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah.
That's neat. That makes for fun racing. So it'll be fun to keep watching that.
But you talk about that. It almost the same thing applies in 250s because you've got Cincerello, who's been in the past the one that maybe made those simple mistakes, like kind of like Marvin's done, where he either went down or tucked the front or that. He's the one not really making mistakes. He's getting good starts. He's not making mistakes in the opening laps. He's getting into good rhythm, and he's putting himself in a position every moto. And that's what we've always said in the 250 class. That's been hard for guys to do. And if you go back and look in previous years, it seems like halfway through the season, someone figures it out, that consistency, and then they get on that roll.
What about the 250 class? So we've seen Adam Cianciarulo now four races in a row. He's not going 1-1, but he's winning four races in a row. I mean, man.
Every start, he's coming around the top five.
What a turnaround,
though. He's not
going
down. He's not making mistakes. He's not. He's really solid. He's used what he's learned over the years and his maturity, and you can see now that it's paying off. And, you know, Justin Cooper was also being pretty consistent. He did that last year, and he was doing it again this year. But a bit of an off weekend for him, but he lost a fair amount of points. So Cianciarulo, I think it's 26 points. So he's got over a moto lead now, and at this point in the season, that's pretty healthy. That's a big deal in that class because it takes a little pressure off that should something happen. Let's just say, God forbid, but a mechanical or that first turn crash and you can't finish. That cushion always mentally helps take a little bit of that pressure off.
I tell you, I'm so impressed by his ability to come back after Vegas. And we had Marty Smith say to us, if you remember on that show, I think a champion is defined or a characteristic that they all have is the ability to just get past a mistake. Just move past it. Don't dwell on it. Let it affect you for the next turn, the next race, the next year. And man, is he showing that. To be able to come back 2 weeks later, turn it around, get the win, and now reel off four in a row. Super impressive.
Didn't surprise me with him because I think we've always said that about him. He's very professional, mature. He's learned to deal with adversity throughout his whole career because I feel like he was that guy. It was only winning was acceptable. So if it didn't win, it was what happened. So he's always had to overcome. But still, it's been a pleasant surprise even to think that he's run off four in a row. Now that's huge.
Hey, is there any word from him, from his camp, on what they thought about Justin Cooper's deal?
No, but I thought it was funny. Somebody made a joke because Cooper went off the track this past weekend.
I saw that.
Yeah. And came back on at the next safest place without gaining an advantage.
Dylan Friend has knocked him off the track. You see that?
Well, whatever. Yeah. However it happened, I thought it was hilarious that somebody called him out and went, are you going to protest yourself? So
that's pretty good.
Anyway, I haven't heard anything from. I think they're staying quiet on it and just taking
I think
the
they said their point, which was Adam followed didn't do anything wrong. Yeah, right. followed the rules. And the way you've written the rules, I don't know how you could say anything different. So it's the rule needs to be redefined a little bit. To me, it's too much gray area, but that's a whole nother conversation.
Yeah, but I don't think what he did was in the gray area.
As it's written, he followed it to the letter.
Yeah,
and he did it.
Actually,
exactly
he did it
right.
better. Him, like I said, we've talked about this before. He backed off. So anyway,
what about the GPs? Let's touch on those real quick. That took a weird turn. Herlings came back, won a moto this last weekend
with a broken ankle.
Yeah, and then he pulled out because someone when he on the parade lap of all things.
Yeah, but he broke his ankle. On the parade lap,
on the parade
of the first moto.
Still
raced
won.
It.
Yeah.
Won the moto. And then a lot of times, maybe when you're just warm and you're going, it doesn't hurt as bad. And then
I didn't
the minute
see
you
how
come
he
in,
did it.
No, it was on the parade lap.
How, I mean, how?
Well, that's the thing. I don't think anyone got it on video or they didn't show it on the TV. And he didn't say too much. He said, I think he said he made a silly mistake, fell on the parade lap.
Somebody hit him.
And then Jessiconis. Maybe it was a blind spot or something, but apparently just hit him and rode over his
now,
leg.
Now, I didn't hear, is it the same ankle that he just came back from?
I don't know that either.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Anyway, really wild.
I'm sure more will come up, but either way, he's out for a while. Cairoli hit the ground pretty hard. No official word of the extent, but I did see that he had a sling and definitely banged up, but I don't know if there's anything broken. It sounds like maybe there's not, but I think they're going to go. I think like we have here in the States, they have a medical team at the track. Sometimes when you're going through real quick, you can overlook something, so they're always going to go to their specialist or their orthopedic surgeon and get more x-rays, MRIs, whatever. So might hear some more, but at the moment it looks like he's dinged up. But I think they have a couple races in a row, which is going to make it tough for some of these guys.
Yeah, and you give up a bunch of points like that, Gasser just opened it up, and he's been on a roll anyway, so it looks like he might really take that series and run.
Yeah, man.
Which is a bummer. I'm a bit of a Tony fan. I mean, I just appreciate the way he does business.
I kind
of
want to see him get his 10th.
It would have been nice to see like his 10th.
The 10th one's become the toughest one for him. Who would have thought that? But it is. It doesn't get easier. That guy's worked hard.
How old is he?
He's in his, I think, isn't he like 34 now?
Yeah.
Tony
he's,
is?
He's not a spring chicken.
Right.
Wow. Crazy. Well, anyway, it'd be fun to see how that turns out. Good luck to Tony. Hopefully that's not too bad. I was thinking AC separation, you know, when they said nothing's broken and your shoulder's hurt, and that's typically what happens. If you got a bunch of pain in there, that AC joint separates, and it can be painful for a short term.
Seems like over there, a lot of guys have hit the ground lately, a lot of injuries. I mean, we have that here too, but it just seemed like at GPs, a lot of big crashes this year.
I want to mention one more thing in our front end chatter segment is we've got a live show coming to Redbud. It'll be the first time we're taking this this show on the road. If you're planning on going to Redbud, it's going to be Friday night. The location to be determined there at the track, but it will be at the track. So
it'll probably be right near where La Rocca's Leap is.
That was kind of the idea was have La Rocca's Leap in the back. Mike La Rocca is going to be our guest.
Lot B, I don't think would be safe enough for us.
It was going to be parking lot B, and then we decided we couldn't bring in a whole security team, so they're finding a safer location.
We didn't want naked chubby men moonwalking across our stage.
Dude, it would be worse than a soccer championship.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah.
We say something they don't like, they just come cut your throat.
Yeah.
But that's going to be a lot of fun. So July 5th, Friday night, before the National at Redbud, come check us out. It's going to be a lot of fun. I believe it's free. I'm not sure how he's doing it. Tim Ritchie, the promoter back there, is kind of setting it up for us. So, but check it out.
We'll know here pretty shortly.
Yeah. I've actually had a couple of email questions, people asking, is it free? Is it not? What's the deal? So we need to...
What they were maybe thinking is having a tent because they don't know how weather is going to be, so to be safe. And they will sell like sort of call it VIP tickets for in there where you'll get a seat and all that. And then they're probably going to have a big screen. And then they'll have like food and beverage vendors there, and everyone can kind of hang out, and they'll be on big screens to listen to if you just want to chill outside.
Yeah, that's going to be a lot of fun, bottom line. So come check it out.
Redbud's always wild. So
we are going to give away a free set of Dunlop tires, and we're going to draw those and maybe two sets. So the way you're going to win is by having some Whiskey Throttle merchandise on, a t-shirt, hat. So get over to whiskeythrottlemerch.com and pick up a hat or t-shirt. You'd be eligible to win a set of the Dunlop tires there at the Redbud show. And we thank the folks over at Temecula T-Shirt Printers for working with us on all our merchandise. Those guys do an awesome job. I want to bring up our guest. I think it's time to get him on up here. So let's welcome up Josh Hansen. He is brought to you by PowerDot. Go to PowerDot.com and check those guys out. So, Hanny, like we mentioned earlier, both of us have known Josh since he first started racing pro. Shoot, even maybe back before then. Kind of followed him as an amateur kid and then as a rookie with YOT. Josh, welcome to the show, bud.
Can I push this down?
Of course you can. You can do whatever you want.
I didn't know.
Yeah. You're not going to get yelled at.
Yeah,
you're okay.
I won't mess this thing up.
How you doing, bud?
I'm good. Just hanging in there, trying to be dad and trying to be a rider and just doing it all, really.
Yeah. It's good, man. It's good to see you, like, still seeing you out riding a lot. And I bumped into you at a track a while back, and we talked a little bit about just how much we both still love to ride, you know? And I think a lot of guys that doesn't. That either fades or goes away or they just get over it. But it's always good when you see a guy that's kind of done with his professional career but still loves to ride. At least I appreciate that.
I enjoy riding. I mean, no matter if I'm racing or not, I truly want to be on a motorcycle all the time. It's kind of like when, I guess, big muscle dudes go to the gym or something or whatever it is. Yeah. It's just they're going surfing in the morning. I mean, that's my deal. So
yeah.
I enjoy it. This is what I grew up doing.
Yeah. Gio likes to go to the gym and just...
He's a big muscle guy. That's why I used it, because I wanted everybody to really understand this whole deal where I was coming from.
Yeah.
You look good, for real.
I have a friend called Jim. That's as close as I get to go to the gym.
Yeah. Or Jim Works. Beam, I thought, right?
Yeah.
No, Perry. Perry.
Jim yep, Perry. Is one of them too.
Beam and Perry.
Yep, Jim Beam. We have a good relationship.
Well, so, Hanny, we would like to start back at the very beginning. So
here we go.
Let's start. Like when you first got started riding and what bike it was.
When I first started, it was a little four-wheeler.
You were a quad guy?
Yeah. I remember, they got me like a little like Suzuki quad right off the bat.
How old were you?
And then it was a PW. I think I was like 3.
Oh, so you got... Was DHMA, was Donnie interested in having you race, do you think?
I don't know what he thought. I was all over the place. I think it was... I think Donnie was down with it if I was.
Yeah.
It was just kind of see what happens. It was a little squirrely.
Get a quad and just... If he gets into it, then go from there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then I dove right into a PW50. So that was like, I just did a weekend warrior stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and just loved it. And my dad did schools and whatnot. So I was just always around people riding. And then, it just kind of built into, I guess, racing one day. But
well, that's interesting. You know, if you're, like you said, obviously with your dad's history and then being around it, was it something that you, like, did you feel like at a young age, like it was something you really enjoyed, was being at the track?
Yeah, I did. I like being at the track. I wasn't really that into racing, super crazy. Okay. You know? But I did BMX more.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I started off doing BMX. So, I don't know. I loved it. I just like being on a motorcycle. Yeah. So. And then, you know, I didn't really start off doing the whole amateur thing until probably I was maybe 9, 10 or something like that, because my dad was already going to the amateur nationals, and it was kind of one of those things. It was like throwing the carrot right in front of me, like, if you don't get in trouble at school, you could be doing this. So that was to try to stay out of trouble. Yeah. was riding.
Were you getting into trouble as a little kid?
Yeah, I got into a little bit of trouble for sure. I had a little a little ADD problem, went a little
tell the teacher she had a dumpy butt.
Yeah, like there's just been crazy stuff, you know. I was a little troubled, but my motorcycle was my savior for sure.
Yeah,
you know, that was my go-to if I didn't get in trouble.
And you grew up in Colorado, right?
No, I actually. So I'm from Granada Hills, Los Angeles.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
so, yeah, and then family moved out to Colorado when I was probably like 12.
Oh, wow.
Something like that, and then I moved back, you know, when I was probably like 17.
And your whole family came back?
No, they're out there. They're still out there.
Okay, they're still in.
Yeah, still out
Donnie's
there.
Donnie's still out there?
Yeah, I mean, he goes back and forth. But yeah. Elbert, Colorado, it's like 20 miles east of Colorado Springs, Black Forest, where all those fires were. Yeah. It's right there. So he likes it. I mean, he can't stand the traffic and stuff.
Yeah, who can?
Yeah, it sucks.
It really does. Like, now me getting older, I'm like, dude, Colorado's the place. I love it.
It's rad.
Colorado is nice.
Yeah.
I'm not a winter guy, but when we got there for
it's
the National.
22.
When we go up there for the National, it's a beautiful place.
Yeah. Too many Subaru Outbacks for me.
That's a lot of Subaru.
It is funny it's when crazy, you go to those dude. Parts of the world. It's like you see all these ads and you look around SoCal. You're like, who even buys these cars? And you go to different parts of the country. You're like, okay.
Those are the guys.
Yep.
Yeah, there's a lot everywhere. Of them.
Well, if you're driving in the snow, those Subarus you are need gnarly. To, yeah. They're rad.
Yeah. I don't know too much about them. I wasn't driving back then.
Who else did you grow up riding with? Did you have any other kids that...
Yeah, I grew up riding with Andrew Short.
Oh, did you?
It's the craziest thing because you'd never ever guess. But yeah, like when I was back in Colorado before, you know, going to Loretta's and stuff, it was Andrew Short, and he'd pick me up from school because I couldn't drive. And he was my riding buddy, and he was my free ride buddy. That's where I learned to even hit jumps, and then I learned how to slam people through Andrew Slur. I learned everything. Like when I was in Colorado, like, dude, I swear, like the
riders. Yeah, because he's a Colorado native, right?
Yeah, but like I learned a lot from Andrew Short. Honestly, like I guess he would never ever guess. I don't know.
I didn't know that.
Was he down in Colorado Springs? Where'd he grow up?
Yeah, right there in Black Forest. So like 5 miles
right
away.
You guys.
Yeah.
Huh.
So. Yeah, pretty I grew cool. up with that whole family. Dude, I remember Hannah before even meeting Morris, you know, and then actually Andrew meeting his wife now, they met at my dad's school in Colorado, Jackie. So, yeah, I remember.
Small
she
world,
was,
huh?
Yeah, she yeah. was motoing.
So if you don't know, Andrew's sister Hannah married Ryan Morris, right? And then what's the other tie in there? Sorry, I just got spun out.
It goes Morris, and then Andrew married Jackie.
Who raced.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And was at a riding school at his dad's riding school, and they met there.
Yeah.
That's cool, man. And Andrew can slam some people. He's like the smiliest, nicest guy, but You don't want to be on the receiving end. Oh, I raced him.
Funny enough, 1 year, 05 was with him. The following year was with Shorty on the West Coast. And yeah, he gave me a good little punt in the first turn at the last race.
Yeah, he's good. He was always pretty good. We had people like Sean Morgan and dudes like that.
I remember
like
that name.
Back in the day, and Chad Wollaston.
Who was the guy, number 356 he always ran?
356.
Oh, gosh dang it.
There's one more There's one more guy that was so fast I can't think of right now. But anyways, those guys would be working each other out at the track. And yeah. I remember I was a little mini rider. And I was like, oh, you got to be like this, you know? As you can see.
You got her. At times, you got her.
And then when I came out of Colorado, I was straight with this dude. I lived with this guy. And all I can do is laugh.
We'll get to that. I'm trying to remember how that even came about.
I think it was from that Glen Helen race whenever I raced you out of an amateur.
Yeah, and then
you came
over.
You were
talking to Brock Sellards.
Yeah.
Brock was staying with me at the time.
Somehow, I don't know, dude. You helped me out a lot, though.
I still remember you.
Andrew Short and Langston were my two guys that I learned a lot from.
Hopefully good things.
It was definitely two end of the spectrums, you know what I mean, in different ways.
Yeah, I was going to say, we're a little different.
But, you know, it was interesting.
Well, we're going to get to those stories when you guys live together, because I think those are fun. Do you remember your first race?
Yeah, I do. It was back in Oklahoma.
Your very first race ever was in Oklahoma?
Yeah. It was in Oklahoma at some race. I don't even know what it was. Like, my dad was... Do you remember Jacob Martin?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was, like, over there working with him or maybe something like that, and I just did... I don't even know what place I got or what. Like, it was just for fun, but...
So it's just probably one of those, your dad was going somewhere and...
Yeah.
He was going to drive and...
Yeah, I had my 50 or something.
Huh. Take on the world.
Jacob Martin. Yeah, I remember that name.
That guy was fast.
That's old. Yeah, he was really fast.
That guy was so, so fast. Yep. Number 9, I think it was. I think he was number 9, at least as an amateur on an 80.
Yeah.
I don't know. I remember those days.
That's funny, man. Was your dad always, like, coaching you, or did he kind of just let you do your thing?
He mainly let me kind of do my thing. I don't think he ever thought I would really kind of get too far with things just because of how squirrely everything was and in trouble. So I didn't, like, growing up and then being around, like, Bucklew and... say Short and all these guys that were really like, you know, by the books and stuff. And then there was a lot of days that I wasn't able to ride, you know, so I was punished for that. So I think that when it came down to being ready for races or whatever, it was, you know, I just remember when I got into middle school, I'll never ever forget, like, it was kind of a thing that I had like one more chance to kind of pull it together, you know.
And from your dad or from school?
Yeah, from my dad. Just to really try to get it together to keep riding and stuff. And I got in trouble a couple of times, but it definitely helped me.
Hmm.
Definitely helped me.
A lot of riders have had some sort of a, like, ADHD.
ADHD.
Yeah, something along those lines. They've always been, like, hyper and this and that. Because when I was a kid, too, I was just too hyper for the way schooling was set up.
Yeah.
It was just too slow speed and too quiet for my liking. So I was also constantly in trouble and was that same sort of battle where my mom's like, you're not going to be riding. And my dad's like, well, let's not take it too far. But, you know, it was the same thing. He was like, get your act together, otherwise we can't go to the races.
Yeah. Dad wanted to go more than you almost probably back then.
No, I wanted to go real bad. It was just hard to behave at school, or it lasted 2 hours and then I did something.
Doesn't your stepmom now, she does a homeschooling deal though, right?
No.
Oh, she doesn't do that? I thought that was what she did.
Not that I know.
Maybe I'm thinking of something else. Did they ever think about doing that, homeschooling you?
They actually did at the very end, like when I was going in and getting my whole like ride and stuff, and I had to be out here the last year.
Okay.
We did it, but...
I know sometimes with ADD, ADHD, that's a better setup because you can like go, okay, let's work on schoolwork for 30 minutes and then go spin circles out in the grass and whatever for a little while.
Good.
Whatever
you got to do. Go run whatever. By yourself out in the middle of the field.
Go run around the block.
Just burn off some of the energy.
Go run through the, what's it, the Black Woods?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Black Forest.
The Black Woods. I love you, dude.
So at what point did you start doing well enough? Because, I mean, I remember kind of the first time I met you is when you were riding for YOT, and I think you showed up in 01 maybe or something. You did a couple nationals.
My first year would have been like 03, 02. My dad tried to like stick me into trying to do something. 03 would have been my first year. It didn't. I got hurt. You know, so 04 was kind of like my first real year of doing a series.
Okay.
When you got hurt, was that when you did your spleen?
Yeah, I did put a hole in my intestines. And I was living with him.
And you were being a fool and free riding.
Yeah, we went out to OCTOLs right before. And then, man, jeez.
And then you tore yourself up. I remember coming to the hospital. You got the handlebar in the gut, yeah. Right? Went into your stomach.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah, it was gnarly. I put a hole in my intestines. I've never heard of such a thing. But
that's gnarly.
Yeah, it was, boy, yeah. That worked me. Worked me.
That happened to Townley before he came over here when he rode for us at TLD. He hit neutral going up a hill and just took a bar to the gut, and it perforated his intestine.
It hurts so bad.
But if that poop gets out of there and starts
poisoning your body,
yeah, that's where I went wrong. Quick. I passed out and then had to get life flighted out.
That was a thing, too. He was hours away from a hospital.
Yeah, I was just by myself. Like, well, I mean, I was with a couple other people. I think at the time it was Bess, Mike Craig. That was like when he was running the team.
Okay.
And I was friends with Bess at the time. And we all went out there, and man, I just,
came up short on
something? No, literally, like, we were just riding on a trail, and you got to really be careful, because when you're looking, everything looks the same out there.
Starts blending, yeah.
Yeah, and then it looks like hills, but on the other side, I mean, there's huge cliffs. Mm. And I just jumped off trail, and I thought there was, like, a little step up, and I was going to jump back on trail, and I jumped up, and it dropped a huge, huge, huge cliff. And then I couldn't get away from it. I tried jumping off, and then my feet caught the bars, and it just came up and whacked me in the stomach. So it was just kind of a stupid thing. Learned a big lesson there.
But that kind of almost ruined that year, right?
Yeah.
Like, it was almost the whole year was a write-off.
Yeah, so basically, I remember my dad, he was pretty upset, like, you know, like, oh, well, you've done yourself. Like, you're already kind of on the fence, and then now you did this, so... So you're kind of screwed. I remember I tried to. I still had staples in my stomach, and this is obviously before you have all the asterisk medical mm-hmm, unit and yeah. all that, you know. So I was able. I didn't want to get in trouble or whatever, so I tried racing Anaheim 1, and I still had staples in my stomach. And I remember I was like 11th or whatever. No, I was maybe doing a little bit better than that, but I remember it came down, and the whoops are kind of big and. A little sketchy as it was, and I remember I went over the bars and tore a couple staples out, and that kind of fucked me up a little bit, so I had to take like the rest of the time off.
Were you at YOT then?
Yeah. So I didn't even really get to race until Vegas, and then Vegas I got like a fourth. That was like my started up kind of going, and then that was the end. Remember, that's when I pulled that chick, dude. I was so hyped. Do you remember that?
Which one?
Do you remember the boost chick in Sellers? Come on, and Ivan, don't you remember how, like...
Boost?
Yeah,
the Boost Mobile?
Ivan and Sellards, and who else was on my team, and, like...
God. Oh, yes, you were so happy with yourself. I remember that.
Dude, it was a woman. I loved her so much.
Oh, yes.
That was awesome.
Some, one of the Boost Mobile chicks.
Yeah, but she was good.
Yeah? You got a picture?
She was so... No. Well,
a mental picture.
Yeah.
I could definitely find her, most likely.
Yeah, no, that was some of Hanny's goals. I think you wanted to win so you could just get all the ladies, all the podium chicks.
No, that was good times, though. That was good times.
All right, did you win any Loretta's titles?
Yeah, I did. I've won maybe one, two. I don't even know off the top of my head. Not that many. I wasn't like some, like, I never, yeah.
You went the Mike Alessi of Loretta's.
Nah, I was never some amateur, grew up winning and all this, and was the next best.
But you even said you had a bit of a late start anyway.
Yeah.
But you were good enough, obviously, to get a YOT ride.
I mean, yeah, like I won Loretta's all my last year. I won actually almost every amateur title that year, and then that got me my deal. And then kind of struggled, obviously, going into the pros right up.
I can't believe you raced with staples in your stomach. That's like,
I
could go wrong so many ways.
I know,
dude.
I was so stupid, man. And I just really just didn't want, I guess, my pops to be bummed, but then more or less me lose an opportunity, even though I was squirrely as hell.
Yeah, you didn't want to,
you know, like,
start your pro career not
racing.
Yeah,
and I had Phil Alderton at the time, so like he you know, it sucks that he's not with us anymore, but at the time he was probably one of the few that would maybe let me do that.
Phil was squirrely.
Yeah,
man.
So Phil would maybe be like, yeah, don't be a pussy. Don't do this shit.
Be like, rah! Yeah, you can do it. You got this.
Face, you know, so, yeah, I mean, we tried.
Dude, Phil tried. Alderton, he was the old owner of Yamaha of Troy. For those of you who don't know, Honda of Troy, Yamaha of Troy. But I went into a dealer signing back there one year for the Troy, Ohio National. And he had all of his mechanics. They were standing around this big tank taking hits off of it. I think it was CO2 or something.
Jesus, just burning himself up. Oh, my goodness.
Like the biggest whippet you've ever seen You know, like these massive cylinders of it. I'm like, I didn't even know what was going on at the time. And they're all,
talking deals. Can we pull a five-year deal off?
Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Now?
Yeah.
All right, so that was '02 with YOT. That had to be 2002.
No, that would have been 2003, 2004.
You did some nationals in 2002 because on the Racer X Vault, it shows you doing some
nationals. Did the last
out of
few.
The amateurs.
Yeah. Okay. You just did that like privateer style?
I did it like, you know how you can kind of get on your ride before your deal really goes through?
Yeah.
It's kind of one of those.
Just jumped on
a
bike.
I jumped on like a Yamaha Troy deal where kind of Chad was just kind of coming out of it, really. You know, but I was just kind of an amateur that was going to get the deal for the following year that they let me get a couple nationals under my belt. That type
of
deal.
Got it. So I peeked through the vault, you know, just like look at your results over all the years. And you've been racing a long time, man.
Yeah. Not consistently.
No, there were some gaps and stuff, but it's like I was giggling to myself because you kind of had your results looked a lot like mine, where you always did pretty good in Supercross. But then outdoors, like, not so much.
Nah.
Well, I remember for a while, I was like, dude, you got to put the effort in. You're like, yeah, I really like Supercross. I'm like, yeah, but you're worth more money if you're good at both.
Yeah, I know. I definitely needed to put more effort in to do outdoors. I can ride outdoors really well. It was just my lack of being, like, lazy at the time. Like, you know, that was my reasoning, I guess.
Unlike most people, it was almost like Supercross came almost too easy for you. Like, I remember watching you when you were a kid, and I was like, dang it. I can't even do some of the stuff he can do on a Supercross track. And, you know, and I've told you that before. I'm like, it was, like, incredible to watch. But I feel like sometimes, like they say, there can be a curse because you always said, I love Supercross. I'm not a big outdoor fan. I'm like, I got to work so hard at Supercross because outdoors came easy. So I get it.
We definitely, when we lived together, like you were gnarly at both, but you had a lot more heart. Like, you know, you'd take tumbles at the track and you'd be all your stuff.
I hit the ground.
And then be doing it, like a foot peg would blow off and you hit a fence or something.
Oh, yeah. The KTM 250 that time. Landed off a triple, and the foot peg didn't come off. The actual frame welding snapped off.
You're telling poor Ping as his front end blew off.
Yeah, hey,
your
didn't
foot
have
peg blew off. Your front end blew off. Like,
so
you think
I get Whiskey
bad for you right now?
As I'm pulling myself back on the bike, I hit the berm.
Oh,
I launched, landed in the fencing at the KTM test track. The bike, you know, like sometimes when your wheel gets stuck in a fence. So the bike was standing up. I got off the bike, and I started walking back to the truck. And they were like, "Hey, what happened?" And I don't even remember what I said, but it was a lot of F. I was like, "F you, F this, F this." And I got in my truck with my gear on. I just threw it in drive, and wheel spun out of there. And I still left, and I was like,
"That thing was."
Did I handle that correctly? But
probably not.
Yeah, I was injured most of that year, so I got to watch a lot of your 04. You had a lot of good speed at a lot of races.
Yeah, I was just, dude. You know, like when you look back at your races,
and you could think a lot of stuff. Yeah, and
dude,
you could fix this.
They always
fix
tell
that.
You you're gonna feel that way one day.
Yeah,
let me tell you.
Yeah,
I don't look at my races anymore.
I know. Sometimes you just gotta go. Okay, it's like a tear off. It happened.
Yeah.
I can't change it.
Yeah.
It is what it is. But like Ping said, if you look here, that's still pretty impressive.
Dude,
all the wins, the gold medals.
Yeah. We'll get there. I want to talk about that more. But so 04, you were second in that series. Take us through that year. And that was with...
Who won in 04?
I don't remember. Stu? No.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
I won one Supercross. That was my first year I won a Supercross.
Yeah, you were second in
YOT still?
Yeah.
Okay.
YOT.
And you were doing East Coast.
Yeah, I did East Coast. I was like, oh, that was when you could start off the series, but then if you didn't get so many points or do the second race, you could drop to the other series. I got hurt that first race and broke my collarbone. So that put me back to, I didn't even do a race, so then I got to go East Coast, and then I got, like, just a lot of, I won one race. I remember Stu had crashed out or something, and that was my first Supercross win, but I remember there was, like, Hepler, and there was a lot of good guys at the time, which I don't think kids, like, would understand these days of, like, you know, when you see Brock Hepler or something, like, how gnarly those dudes were. Like, they were fast.
Mm. It's funny. I hadn't seen him in a while. I just saw him on the weekend at Mount Morris.
Really?
Oh, did you?
I was like, hey.
Yeah.
And,
dude, it's funny because I hear he's like a school teacher or something, or
physical education teacher or something like that.
Yeah. But either way, like, that guy, he was so fast.
Yeah. He was
a
good.
A lot of good guys, you know, even Davey and a lot of dudes I just like grew up with racing, and Gene Stoll. Like, there's just a couple kids.
I remember that.
Shane
name.
Best. There's just some heaters. Michael Blose. Like, there's a lot of good names that it would just blew my mind. They were better than me, you know, or at least faster. I grew up every year winning amateur titles, you know. And obviously, I started, you know, doing good against them towards the end, but they were the solid amateur kids like Alessi, like coming up through the ranks.
Well, that's what I like when we've had this talk before when you're like, ah, my career out, and you kind of poo-poo it. None of those guys have Supercross wins that you do. So, you don't have titles, and we'll talk more about that later, but like, man, you got to be really proud of what you accomplished.
Yeah.
Because look at all those fast kids you're talking about. And I had the same thing in my era. Yeah. There's a ton of fast dudes who never really won anything, or maybe they won one race. You know, like, it's just, it's not easy.
Yeah, it's not. But, I can't say that I'm, like, super, super, super happy on how my whole career went, you know. And, you know, you always hear that you may feel that way. But, yeah, I'm not. Like, I think there was, you know, like GL said, it was too easy at times, where I think that there's some titles that should have been done, and certain, you know, there's a time and place for everything. You know, maybe luck doesn't go a certain way or whatever, as you can see Adam Cincerello or something, you know, like maybe a lot of things don't make sense, but you also got to put yourself in position. And I think I maybe did a lot of stuff where I you just never think of these days. So that's something that, you know, people go, oh, well, you still have it now, go back and race and do all this, and I still feel like I could be good. But at the same time, it's like me going ahead and racing, let's just say we went back to the lights class and beating an Adam Cincerello. He's awesome, he's badass, but that's like a kid towards me. Like, he can basically be my kid. That I don't know that would be satisfying. I don't know if that would ever be satisfying, and that's not degrading, nothing to do with him, but I don't know how it could be satisfying at this age to win a title and be cool with it now.
Yeah.
Like, I don't feel like this is in my, I want to beat the guys that I looked up to or whatever. And that was like GL, like when we went head to head for a title or whatever, like that would, like a title like that would have been something you can wear on your sleeve. Cause you know, like I not only looked up to him, but like that was during my era that.
Yeah.
It isn't like my kid, little Adam Cincerello, I don't even know if he was riding back then, or maybe he was riding a 50. But my point is, like, he just.
Yeah.
He was coming out of diapers.
When I sleep at night, maybe I get the money. I wouldn't feel good about it. And I'm bummed on how I didn't take advantage of it in certain areas.
But you can't dwell on that shit.
No, I can't. But I still ride dirt bikes and stuff. But, I mean, that's cool. I won Supercrosses. But I want to have titles. And then I want my riding to speak for myself.
But really, what would that change?
Just for me to sleep. That's it. It has nothing to do with anything
Ambien.
Else.
Like, I don't know.
Take Ambien. Take Ambien. All right. You're right. I should.
I'm just saying. Yeah. We're going to talk more about it later, because I want to get into that with you. Like, we're going to have a little therapy session.
I got you. Okay. All right.
All right. So what about the next year?
Well, you signed with KTM.
Yeah. You signed with KTM, Troy Lee Designs.
Yeah.
You're riding TLD gear. I remember your stuff looked good that year.
Yeah.
It was funny, because it was a bit of a switcheroo. I left KTM because I wanted to leave. Because I had just had a couple frustrating seasons.
Because you had foot pegs break off.
I had more than that. And but they were going to go on the 250 four-stroke route at that point. And I'd almost lost faith in KTM, if it makes sense.
Yeah.
And they'd made a lot of promises. But I was skeptical, thinking, I don't know if they'll be able to pull through with what they're sort of promising, like saying we've done all this R&D.
And you had every right to be skeptical.
And I think your skepticism was right.
Yeah, but I also think it was maybe... You know, that old saying, timing, you know, for Hanny, it was probably a good opportunity there too, right? Yeah. I mean, didn't they offer you a Supercross only deal?
Yeah, they did. Well, no, not at the beginning.
Oh, okay.
Not at the beginning, no. But
So when you signed that deal in 05, that was your 3-year deal?
That was a 3-year deal.
And that was like a really good deal.
Yeah, it was 1.7.
Yeah. Do you remember the conversation you and I had after you signed that deal?
No.
So I told this when Button was on, because Button was your agent.
Yeah.
And we
him and Asafin.
That contract came up, and I said, man, I remember having a conversation with Hanny when he signed that. I said, dude, because I've always been a little more pragmatic and like conservative. I was older. I was older too. You know what I mean?
I thought I was, but I wasn't that great either.
Yeah. So I said to you, I said, listen, man, if you can just put away that money that KTM pays you for these next 3 years. You can still, you know, like whatever you get from your gear and your goggles, like that can be bonuses, your fun money. Put your race bonus money and your KTM money away by real estate. Just put it in a safe place. I said, you'll be set for the rest of your life.
Dude.
And you like, and you know what you said to me? Yeah, Ping, but like you're older. Like I'm just young. I want to have fun, man.
That's a typical Andy.
I'll never forget that. When I was like, well, okay. I mean.
He said it straight up.
Okay.
And that sounds like Hanny. Yeah, but you're old and boring, man. Like most people want a Lamborghini. I need two Lamborghinis.
Yeah, man.
You spent more fucking money in those 3 years than I probably made my whole career.
Yeah, no, I've done some stuff for sure.
Okay, but tell us about that 05 season, because you two went tooth and nail for that title, and you tied. Yeah.
And Davey was in there.
Yeah.
Davey won a couple races. Millsaps.
Okay.
So it was Grant sort of a three-rider battle most of the season. We didn't have too many battles because I felt like, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like most of the races, I think the first race, I had arm pump and you were on my ass the whole time and I was just happy to get through that. Then it seemed like the next couple races.
I think it was more you, Davey did, right?
Because in the next two races, you didn't get the start, and Davey and I battled.
We're always
and
opposite.
Then it seemed like the following race, you got the whole shot, and I got a bad start. And it was like we didn't really battle a whole lot.
Yeah. It just came down to points, points, points.
It was like you'd have a good weekend, then I'd have a good weekend, and you'd have a good weekend.
Did you win Daytona?
It was, I did win Daytona.
I remember that you won Daytona. Yeah. That's another, dude, that's a big feather in your cap to win Daytona.
So the year before I got third. So then I came into it the next year, like I was like, all right, well, cool, man. You know, I can probably do good here. And then I remember I ended up winning. That was
you and JG went down the last lap. Yeah. I think that's where that term pickup pass came from.
Yeah.
Because they were calling it the pickup pass.
You knocked him down on the last lap?
Yeah.
Well, they both went
together.
For it.
Yeah, I wasn't necessarily trying to knock him down, but I was definitely tired and it was kind of getting down to the end. But
I wanted to win. It was the last lap, wasn't it?
It was the last lap, but I wanted to win so bad, like just to say Daytona, just because like so many people had like. It was an opportunity, and obviously people write me off hard, you know, on certain stuff. So I was really wanted to make it happen. I remember I went down with them, and I messed up my knee. And I remember I messed up. I ended up winning, but I messed up my MCL, my PCL. Oh.
In that crash?
I had to have surgery or whatever. Sucked. Like right when I got up, you can kind of see my leg wobble. It was weird. I don't know what I caught it in or how. Just nicked it, right? Weird deal.
Mm. Yeah.
I don't know.
I just remember I crashed my brains out. And I always wanted to win Daytona, too, because there was a place that I felt
Did
really good at.
Did you not win Daytona ever?
Never.
That is tight.
I think I won.
You suck.
I think I won almost like every heat race there, and I screwed it up every time, every damn time.
Yeah. Should have listened to your roommate.
Hey.
You should have listened to your roommate.
I know.
I led 14 laps there in 97.
Did you?
And got passed by Ferry and Dowdy in the last lap.
Oh, my goodness.
Got third. So, see, you did something neither one of us have done.
No, that's cool.
I think I got one podium there. It was 02. Chad and I came together, and I went down, and I got third. I think it was my only podium. I crashed every other race.
So you two in 05 didn't – it wasn't like a back and forth between the two of you. It just was a points deal.
That's why I said it was kind of weird. I don't think we really battled. I just remember the closest we were was the opening round where you were up my ass the whole moto.
Yeah.
And I still thought you were going to take a dive or a lunge, but you didn't.
Were you still roommates?
No,
because this was 05.
Where were you living? Oh, you moved up to Marietta.
You would have been in the house right across from Louch's old house in that whole area.
Yep.
You were in Greer then or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that house.
Do you still have that house?
No.
For some reason, I thought your parents were there.
Mm-mm. Parents are in Canyon Hills.
Were they there for a little while, though? Didn't they rent it
maybe
or stay there?
Way back in the day.
Yeah. I remember going up and visiting one day. Maybe they're just staying with you.
So how many Lamborghinis did you buy? How many cars did you buy in that 3 year span?
Jesus.
I don't know. Come on, tell us what you spent.
If Instagram was firing back then, it'd be fun.
I think you changed cars more than your underwear at that point in time.
Yeah, you were on there too, though. We were all...
Yeah, Gio, you were not saving your money all over the place.
That's what I said. I was trying to
but
be good.
Hey, but he was winning championships. So that's something else. You know what I mean?
That's how I justified it. I'm like, well, with a championship bonus, I deserve a new car. That other one's got like 3,000 miles on it.
I don't want to change my tires. I'll just change the car.
Exactly.
This one needs an oil change.
Yeah.
I'm over it.
Yeah. I don't do oil changes.
Oh, man. If I could go back, I'd be driving my Toyota. But I can't even give... I've had a lot of cars. Yeah. If I can say that the way career, went and saying, did I take advantage of having fun? At least I did something and didn't let it all, be screwed. But I don't know. I mean, I definitely lived it for sure.
Another story Button told us was you called him from a car dealership. You're like, hey, I think it was a Lambo, right? Was it one of the Lambo? And Jimmy's like, listen to me. Get in your car and go home right now. He's like, go home right now, all right? And you're like, I'm going to check it out.
And he says, I already talked to the salesman.
He says an hour later, he hears this pull up in front of his office. And there you are in this brand new Lambo. And he's like,
Jesus, dude, idiot. Me, not Jim. Me.
What'd that Lambo cost?
Dude, I don't remember at the time.
Were you leasing them or buying them?
I did leases too. At the end, I did leases more because then I realized how stupid it was.
You're like, it's a tax write-off. Okay, don't judge me.
Well, you could at least write it off if you leased it.
Yeah.
You're not going to write much off if you buy
it. It was a catch 22, but I did some stupid stuff and then I started catching on. I can't say it was smart because you keep going, but it was definitely in a smarter way.
Well, usually when guys get Lambos and Ferraris, they're in their 60s and 70s and they're trying to get laid, but at least you weren't in your 60s and 70s.
16s and 70s.
Yeah,
you 60s, 70s, 16, 17s.
So you were the kid in the Lambo. So I know because I was there with you sometimes. You did have some fun and you also...
Dude, honestly...
You've got a lot of good-looking chicks.
I love them all.
We know that. A lot of love from Hanny for all the ladies.
Love you all.
Love you, every one of you.
Yeah.
Why pick? Yeah. Just take them all.
Love you all. I look back, some of those cars, I would never, ever drive that shit now, even if I ever had the money. Somebody could give me one for free, but, there's no chance you're catching me in one of those things.
Yeah.
It sucks. So, you live and you learn.
You had fun.
Things do change.
Yeah, I had fun.
So let me ask you this, because I saw a post, I think Ken Roczen posted something yesterday. Chase Sexton's out looking at this Audi R8 or something.
Don't do it. It's easy to say. It's easy, though. Come on. It's not even worth it. Because 10 years from now, you're not going to give a shit about that car. 5 years from now, you're going to be like, this thing sucks. So it's it's all bullshit. If you can get it for free, other than that,
who gives? Let me give you my old man speech real quick. Put that shit in the stuff that appreciates. You own stuff that appreciates. You rent stuff that depreciates. That is just a basic investment tenet.
Even saving your money and the money that you make, even in the sport, isn't even that much money if you really look at it. So at the end of the day,
we got to live a long time off the racing.
Yeah, you think that it's going to be short-lived. So even being by the books or whatever, you still got to be on top of your game to figure out what the next step is, no matter if who it is. So. Yeah,
the thing that's hard is that at 18, 19, 20, 22, you don't have enough perspective to go, okay, I'll race till I'm 30. Then if I live into my 80s, I have 50 years to go. That's a long time.
And to figure out what you're going to do to keep you going.
You just don't think. Yeah, when stuff slows down, then it's the money leaves your account a lot quicker.
Then it comes in.
Yeah. You know, so.
Well, that's also, crazy. I think, the problem, too, for a lot of young athletes, and that is when the money's coming in, and it's coming in pretty good, and it's coming in every month. I think there's a part of us that just feels like, oh, I can buy a car this month, and then the next month I'm going to get another 50 to 100 grand check. I could buy another car for what? You almost lose the value of a dollar.
Well, you said,
I know I did, because like I said,
100%.
I made good money for a while, and I remember I always was like, no man, I got a lot more coming in than going out, so I'm doing the right things. But I look back and I'm like, there was still a lot going out that didn't need to. You know, there was a lot of wastage looking back, because you think now, like back then, 50 grand at times seemed like nothing. You know, like, oh, it's a down payment. You know, yeah, I'll get that new motorhome, whatever. Now I'm like, you know how long it takes to make 50 grand?
Dude.
Or how hard it is?
I equate everything now to, and this is just getting older and getting perspective, getting a real job. Like, I equate everything to a 24-hour shift at the fire department. I got to work a 24-hour shift to make, like, of overtime, to make, like, $450. So when something costs me $500, $600, you know, $700, I'm like, God, that's 2 days, man. I got to work for 2 days, like, running a bunch of medical aid
like
calls.
A heat race is 4 minutes long. Yeah. You could push $5,000 out of a heat race for a win.
So that's what I'm saying. As a kid, as a young racer, you have no perspective of how hard it is to make that money and how quickly that stuff will go the minute those checks aren't coming in. I mean, you could have people telling you, like, I'm sure Button was telling you, I told you, all
Button,
these people.
Asked me, they all told me. I mean, at the end of the day, it's like you get caught up in that you're the racer and that you're this guy and that becomes the person that you are. But really, at the end of the day, racing or your job or what you do is just what you do. The person that you are. Or you can still be one of the greatest racers, be the baddest dude, win everything and still be an asshole outside the bike, you know what I mean? Or not be a good person or whatever. And I think that you making good decisions, and there's just so much more to life when you have kids and stuff, and I'm learning it now. It's crazy. It really is. So there's a lot more than dirt bikes. This is something that we can do, and this is something great for our life, and we're super lucky to do it, but this isn't the people that we are.
How old are you now? 35, how old are you now?
35.
When did you kind of start realizing this? I mean, it's not this week, right?
No, I mean, probably the last like 5 years. You know what I mean? You really
well,
start.
Well, also,
kind of
I think
doing
anytime
it.
I think you have a kid, yeah,
me in the face, you know. But it took a while. I'm a late bloomer on a lot of stuff, you know. So it's like just, I don't know. I mean,
it's like you're a kid at heart, because even though like you're 35, you still strike me as like the kid I remember.
No, I know.
Like, you haven't changed as far as your personality. Yeah. You've learned a lot and you've matured like the rest of us. But you've always been the same. And I've always said, like, maybe people that don't really know you or they've heard some stuff or just thought he was a show off. Like, Hanny's one of the, you've always been one of the coolest guys down to earth. Even when we battled, you know, like, at times things might get a little awkward, but we've always been cool and you've always been a great guy. And I think, you know, like you were saying, having kids makes everyone grow up a little bit too.
Yeah.
And,
well, that just shows you, it changes your perspective on what's important. Like, and that's what I, you know, one of the things I wanted to talk about is like, you, when we were asking you to come on the show, you were like, nah, you know, my career's not worth talking about. And oh, it's like, look,
it's not about championships.
Racing doesn't define you. It's not who you are. It's just what you did or what you still do, you know, in your case. But it's like, That doesn't have anything to do with who you are as a person. And so I think you're figuring that out, and I love to see it.
I don't know. I just didn't want to come on the show and try to be that guy that's trying to keep something going. That, like, I just, you know, if people are watching me ride or whatever, I want them to respect it for my ride, not the way I tie my shoes or I did my hair that day. Or
you don't do your hair. You wear beanies.
That's right. How cool my beanie is or how cool my Instagram is. Like, you know, riding, I want it to be for what it is. There's the YouTube star stuff going on. That's just not my thing these days, man. That's like,
watching you ride is cool. You've got
your style, man.
Beautiful techniques.
It's always when you posted something, you riding at Deegan's place, and like
so fun.
The way you flow with the bike, and you're always flying like front end low. I
don't know what to say about that. I get kind of embarrassed when people talk about it, because it's not like, you know, people are like, oh man, you're just impressed by your front end low, and I'm like, you know, if I want to impress, you kind of want to go upside down and make it sick, not like, hey.
Oh, and you've done that too.
Hey, and then look at the crowd.
Yeah.
Like, check out this front end. Did you just see my front end low? Like, so like,
that's called confidence.
And I'm like sitting there just like, I feel kind of cornball, but I don't know. I don't know what to say.
Well, take the
just,
compliment.
Yeah, no, it's cool. Just I take appreciate the compliment. It. I love it. I'm excited to ride dirt bikes. I love riding dirt bikes, so that's cool. That
you have to realize that in the amateur world, or the rest of us that are vets or whatever, we never have an opportunity to look like that.
Yeah.
We always look cornball. So the fact that you look so amazing, it's just
cool.
Like, it's a gift.
I never liked my style. And so I would, when I'd watch people like you, I'd be like, I wish I could ride like that. But then I'd see Brock come by and his head starts. So I'm like, I'm not that bad, am I?
I love him so much, dude.
Oh, sorry, Brock. We had to give you a little hard time about the weeble wobble.
We got to get Sellers on this show.
Oh, dude, he's so. You guys would be on here for 4 hours. Dude.
Talk about his Volkswagen Rabbit.
All right. Where the hell are we at? What about the 06 season? So you came off of 05, lost that by just but wins, right? He had, what, one more win than you did?
Yeah.
But now you thought you'd won the championship when you crossed the line, huh?
Yeah, well, so when they came off, they had originally told, or at least Larry Brooks and them, had told me that I'd won. So when I came off, they even gave me my number one jersey, my Troy Lee number one jersey. Oh. And I was bummed. And I was hyped because I started going around the stadium too. You know, I was hyped. I was just like, dude, my bonuses are massive. I won the first championship for KTM in Supercross. I'm like, dude, it's awesome.
Yeah, it's a big day.
It's a big day. This is awesome, you know? Like, first father, son, blah, 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 blah. Come back. And then all of a sudden, I see Langston. Ah! I'm like, fuck's he so happy about? You know, and then all of a sudden they're like, hey, we made a mistake, this and that, you know, that we have to give to him, gosh. You know, he has one more win than you this year. And I just remember, damn, I still got that number one jersey sitting in my Colorado house, hung up downstairs in the closet.
So was that tough for you? I mean, our careers kind of parallel a little bit there, because when I at Dallas in 2000, the original chatter was, you won, I think you won, because remember there was that whole first turn crash and all that stuff. And so I'm like, you know, I'm waiting for the official word, but I'm like starting
about to peak. Yeah.
About to peak. And then it was like, oh, no, Bentley.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Because so, I remember Bones telling me that story, and Bones said, he said on the headset to Mitch, Pingree won, we lost.
Yeah. No, that was the original word. Yeah.
That's crazy. It's
so that's, I wanted to ask you if that was tough for you to like get past, or did that just, it screwed me up for probably a year and a half.
At the time,
just mentally,
it didn't even bug me because I thought I'd for sure win.
Like, you'll get them next year kind of thing.
I'll win next year. Yeah. I'll win one of these years, so it's no big deal. Mm. Larry Brooks, like, everybody, like, I had confidence in myself that it was just going to happen. I didn't really, like, trip out. I was bummed because I really wanted to, but I was just like, all right, well, it's on. Now, later on in life, you're like, damn, you know, this and that. But
I rode like shit that night. You rode really good.
Yeah, it just came down to just here and there, you know, like it was just
well, like you said, as you look back, you know, like,
what did you get that night?
Fourth. But I rode
so if you'd have got fifth, you'd have won.
Well, and the worst part is fifth place.
I don't mean to like rub it in. Yeah. I'm just saying it comes down and just inches.
I rode way too conservative and tightened up, and I knew Hanny was leading, but I'd done the math. I knew fourth was good enough. And I was in fourth, and then I remember like fifth and sixth were catching me because I was riding like such a wanker. And I was like, I cannot, this can't happen. Like, there's the carrot. I'm so I kind of dug deep and I just managed to get through it. But I wasn't that stoked on, like, I was irritated with my ride.
Yeah.
I was really disappointed to get fourth. But at the same time, for me, to get a Supercross championship was like, it wasn't anything that I really thought that I always thought I could do it, but it was one of those things.
You came in hurt too, didn't you?
That's why I did East, because I was dealing with a wrist injury and carpal tunnel. But it worked out because Ivan wanted to do West for Mitch, and I was like, I need all the extra time. And
so did you, when you crossed, you knew you had won?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't even know what this
asshole doing?
Yeah.
You know what? I saw him wave, but I'm like, he's pumped. He did all he could. He won the race. That's what you had to do that night. Yeah. You knew you had to go out and win and hope that I would ride worse than I did.
I just remember going into it, and Larry Brooks, like, all right, you know, like, he's super, super, super intense. And I know that, you know, like, riding for him, like, and he was a great team manager, but he just told me,
Larry wants to win really bad.
Yeah,
that's what I remember about him.
He helped me out a lot. Like, we went into it, and he's like, listen, he's all, listen to your kid. I'll never forget him saying, he's like, we got to win practice, we got to win qualifier, and we're gonna win main event, and however the cards fall, that's however we're gonna do everything we need to do. And I'm like, all right, 10-4. So we went out there first practice, and I remember I thought I put a couple down, and I remember I qualified, if I'm not mistaken, like maybe 18th or something, like so bad. And I remember, like, I thought I ripped a couple laps. I'm like, no way. And I came back in, and I remember he was pissed. He's like, what? I'm like, so I went back out there, did bad for the next practice, and then first qualifier I won, and then won the main event. And then, yeah
you figured it out. Yeah.
But yeah, I had to like pull it together during the races. I was like, dude, I gotta win this thing. I can't, like, I don't know. You want to do it so bad because you're right there. It's like you got to give it that one last effort. You know, we're almost to the home plate.
Well, it's still a record. We're the only ones who've ever tied in a championship.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. It's never been done. It's been close. I mean, there's been 1-2 points several times, but never a tie points.
Yeah.
Not the record you want to be attached to, but I know. But anyway,
well,
it is a record.
Than this. I don't know. I'm cool with it. Whatever. I mean, you're an asshole.
So 06, you stayed with KTM again?
Yeah, I did. But I ended up messing up some discs in my back, herniated discs and stuff. And 06, 07 was a washout for me. Mm. Like, I could not get – I remember I was going to a bunch of doctors and stuff. Larry was trying to help me with that at the time. But I really had a bunch of problems with that.
And then, I
don't remember after that. Oh, and then they were going to re-sign me after that, and I could maybe do 450. I told them I want to go 450. They're like, stay lights. You can maybe, you know, win a championship. And I'm like, no, I want to go 450 at the time. So I remember Kurt Nicole was even talking about maybe even trying to do maybe my own team. Oh, not my own team, but my own whole deal, underneath KTM. So it'd be the lights and then maybe me. And I remember I thought I was sweet. And started talking to JGR, and JGR for 08 was this big team that was coming out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, had this, had that, Jeremy Albrecht, he's James Stewart's mechanic, blah, blah, blah. So I was super hyped on all that. Like, that was like the team to go to, you know?
They were Yamahas.
They were Yamaha. So I ended up taking way less money to go do that deal.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Then if you had stayed at KTM.
Oh, yeah. I was an idiot. I mean, in all respect towards
well, yeah, but
I should have stayed at KTM.
That 450 KTM then still had some work to be done on it.
Yeah, it
so.
Did. But the way it all worked out at JGR and all that, it would have been – it just the whole deal just like I really lost myself after
that.
Well,
they were a startup team, and a lot of times with startup teams there's growing pains, and there's a process that has to go through.
Yeah.
And I know even with J-Bone, he mentioned one time that you know, it took a little time for them to kind of find their feet because, you know, even just being on the other side of the country compared to, you know, you got Yamaha in California. Yeah. Just
everybody
everything.
Stuck for their
way. Yeah. And then there's a disconnect here and the testing didn't work and, you know, so I think there was just some startup pains that they had too that held them back.
So how did that season go then?
That season, if I can remember right, it was pretty short-lived. We definitely disagreed on a lot of stuff all the way around. I remember it was more like football mentality. I don't think it's like that anymore, but it was more like they had a football trainer. They had a
I remember you said you didn't like the trainer.
No,
it didn't
I did
work
like the trainer. He was a really nice guy, super good guy, but the whole deal just – I didn't understand it. And at the end of the day, what I kind of told Coy, I was just like, dude, you know, I've never been this physical guy, which you have to be, but you got to have it mentally. You could be physically all you want. If you don't have it mentally, you're screwed. And I was not about the program. Like, you would ride out. I remember it snowed so bad, and his whole deal was, you don't miss these days. You got to go ride out in the snow. But we couldn't even get the bikes in. We couldn't get out of the parking lot because there was so much snow and ice. Yeah. But we had to go ride in it. That like just stuff like that didn't make sense to me.
Did you move back there?
I moved back there. Yes.
So. That was mandatory back then.
Yeah, back then that was.
It was like you didn't have a train. There was like just a lot of different rules. They'd do bed checks on me in the middle of the night.
What?
Yeah, like he showed up a couple times during the middle of the night, and then I remember.
Just to make sure you hadn't snuck out or something.
Just doing anything bad or whatever, like. I don't understand it, but
it was full football camp mentality. Yeah,
but I remember, and it wasn't all the time, but I'll never forget that he'd have us go to the gym, and obviously I hated going to the gym, but we would do it like say first thing in the morning, we would go ride, and then we'd come back, and then you'd have to do an afternoon session, and then I remember
session of what
of training again.
Okay,
so. I remember like one night he came and woke me up. I was like, it was late at night or whatever, middle. And then he's like, get up. And I remember it was a blizzard outside, dude. And I remember he's like, you're going to go ahead and you're going to go running. And with the trainer. I'm like, what?
Who was your teammate? Summy?
Summy.
Yeah.
And I was so pissed because I think he was almost like, with the football mentality, I think now looking back at it, it was almost like testing me to see. And I remember I was just loose. I was just like, fuck, like there's no way I'm going to do it. And if you're going to be going to Christmas, whatever, you're going to go do this. It was like my third time training that day. I was pissed. I remember we had like after that night, I remember, and the trainer, I remember when I met up with him, was pissed that he even had to do it. I was like, yeah, fuck, I was yeah. over it. I really had a negative attitude, and it maybe just didn't line up exactly. So I can't put all the blame on.
Well,
that.
That's a little bit stupid, but, though, but right? If you wake you up in the middle of the night and go run in the snow.
I think
and that's
it was
testing,
more,
like he said.
And it didn't happen all the time, you know. Like I that right there happened one time. I remember out in the snow. But it was just like. I remember I didn't.
You feel like you're being checked up on the whole time. And you're like, leave me alone, man.
I was upset about a lot of stuff. So.
I get it. I don't think that you can have a one size fits all program with when you're dealing with different athletes. Like one of the things I've watched and learned is, you know, people have said if you're not on the Alden Baker program, you can't win. And I said, I disagree with that 100%. I think he has a great program, and I think it works for a lot of people, but it doesn't work for everyone. Since didn't work for Cincerello, didn't work for Ken Roczen. Tomac doesn't train there, so you can't tell me that's the only way to go. And knowing someone like Hanny's personality, if you try and basically cage him and tell him what to do, he's going to rebel. Hanny's the kind of guy, he needs encouragement to maybe do the longer moto or maybe do something more. He's a rider, and I would have said, if I was working with you, I would have said, okay, let's take his strengths and weaknesses and let's focus on, one, get him happy and comfortable on the bike, and then let's get the motos in. If we know we can do the motos, you're good. Sticking Hanny in the gym, I don't think was – I wouldn't have done it.
I fell short, though. Like, as much as I can blame that whole situation, it's my fault, too. Because, you know, it, like, takes two people to really get
well,
into it, more or less.
You've
and
moved
I think
across country.
I
you're by yourself. Yeah. You've got a – they got a drill sergeant sort of mentality, which is not – so you add it all together, I probably also would have been a little bit like
– it was rough. I know that when – Grant went over there and Brayton, I think that was kind of their first year of really kind of starting to make change where they're letting people maybe do a little bit different with training or more, you know, before you didn't really have a choice at all.
Yeah, they definitely changed their way of doing it. I remember in the early days hearing some of the stuff.
But they had such an awesome setup, though. You know, like their tracks and stuff and their whole facility and us being back east, I think is – looking back at it, it's really good.
I could see for sure for the summer.
I think it's really cool. But
definitely had its pros.
The winters kind of were gnarly. Like when I said.
Well, you guys had weather there that, like you said, prevented you from riding.
Yeah.
I remember hearing.
There was a lot of cold days riding, and that's a tough one to like be out there and try to like test and get something going.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Freezing. Yeah.
I remember their big thing was we're not going to California. We're done with California. So that was like the whole football mentality. Now I think that they're more. I see that they test at the Omaha track. Mm. Like before, there was no way we were showing up at the Omaha.
Well,
track.
Then go south. Go to Florida. Go to.
He did. They went to Atlanta. I remember we went to Michael Burns, but man, it was like 6 hours up the road or five, but it was still so cold.
Oh yeah.
It wasn't like it was super massive different. Rainy or something.
Just no snow.
Yeah.
But so you did 1 or 2 years with him?
It was supposed to be two.
did it end up short?
I got clippied.
At the end of the first year?
Yeah, not even at the end, like halfway through. Like we didn't see eye to eye on some stuff. And then, I got like that.
So what'd you do?
I remember I was screwed. I was happy, but I was so screwed.
Were you?
I've never been so happy to come back to California. Yeah. But then at the same time, I knew because there's so much respect for that team and them having their first year. And then obviously they're like, oh, well, of course, Hanny did it.
Well, that was
so
the hard part. Yeah.
I was screwed trying to get anything else going.
Because everyone thinks now, like, it's all
Yeah, if
you're
not
going
to work out there with, like, this guy that has private jets, football, this, that, the very best, this, who else is going to pick them up? So it was really hard because most people that ever hang a left in this whole motocross thing, they're usually out.
Yeah.
Had a couple times.
Yeah, it's true. Not a lot of people come back.
It's pretty cutthroat at times. Yeah. But, yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I think people see through that sometimes. I mean, at the end of the day, you did have an opportunity with Mitch, and a lot of people, I think, were surprised when Josh Hansen signed with Pro Circuit. I think a lot of people thought that's never going to work.
Yeah.
So the next deal you signed was with Hart and Huntington then?
And
that was oh
that would have been
seven?
That would have been
a little later than that.
Oh eight. That would have been kind of 09. I was going to do it, but then their bikes were so bad.
The Hondas.
At the time. The 09 Honda for some reason like
that was bad.
That was the only time like when I rode a Honda like other than the 08 and I was like tripping. I didn't understand because remember they didn't have the links. There was something weird going on with that
I remember hearing that bike
the
wasn't
09
very popular.
Honda was very stinky.
That's right.
And
but they didn't have anything with it. And then I remember there was it was definitely that during that time like Hart's team was kind of it was definitely a shit show coming off of like doing even...
Yeah, but they had go-go dancers on boxes with smoke machines.
And that's why I backed
That's a proven team right there. I got all the tools I need.
I went from JGR to that, and I'm like, all right, well, we don't have factory parts, but you got chicks on go-go dancers, so what? Like, what do you want?
Yeah.
Do you want pressure or do you not want pressure?
Hold on. All right, we'll go to the go-go dancers.
So that was 09. So 08.
But I only rode a tiny bit.
And so then, 07, you just didn't do anything at all?
No. I wasn't even able to really race because my back was so jacked. That's so bad. It was insane.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you do anything or just give it some time to...
I tried giving it. I just was going through doctors and whatever. I had to, basically, my year was screwed.
I remember I felt bad for you at that time because people were getting kind of down on you and kind of shit-talking you. And I was like... Because some people say he's not even trying, he's just collecting a paycheck. And I'm like, we're buds, I actually know. I remember some people like, yeah, it's that Lamborghini with that shitty suspension that's going to help his back. Yeah. You know, and I was like, oh boy. You know, like people get so like critical. But I remember at that time, I remember you were like, man, I don't know what to do with my back. And if you remember, I think I mentioned to you that I had had herniated discs when I'd left KTM after my 11,000th crash. I was having back issues too, and I had to deal with it, and it took a long time.
Yeah.
And in fact, that's why I didn't really ride all of 04.
It's called PDS back.
What?
PDS,
PDS back, yeah.
That's what's going on here. I got that.
We all had it at some point.
Yeah.
Okay, so 08, you actually, this is when I was managing Troy Lee Design's Supermoto team.
Yeah.
And you signed up over here to do X Games for us.
Yeah. Just a one race deal, right? Yeah. Really?
Yep, just because I was talking to Troy. Troy's always been a good dude. He's always been a supporter, you know, to my situation. So I was like, he gave me the opportunity to ride X Games. I didn't have anything at that moment in time. And then Red Bull was involved at the time in Honda. They let us ride at the Honda track. And then I remember we needed a motor. Honda stepped up for us. We went over to X Games and we ended up winning. That was cool. That was, I was only on the bike for that week, but dude, the bike was so good. That 08 Honda was so good. I don't know why I got on that bike and really, really, really liked it. And it was all pro circuit. Yeah. It was all pro circuit, suspension, motor, everything. And it worked so good.
I was watching that bike race in the stands.
You could still race that bike.
I think
and it'd be
great.
Competitive.
Yeah.
I'm
was
telling you.
Like, so to ride that bike in 08
and then go to
09, I was like, wow. So right then and there, when I didn't want to do the hard thing, like I already seen where that was going to go. Like it was a no go. Like I definitely did not want to be out there racing. So it's like, okay, cool. So I see I probably maybe need to quit racing, right?
So that was, so 09, you didn't even get through the whole year?
Dude, I was so bummed. No. Like, because
I remember.
Right away.
Okay.
I was like, dude, my career's done. Like I was bummed on myself. I started going down a bad road. I was like, I remember I stayed on Billy Payne's cat. I lost everything. I lost a lot of my money. I lost like
to where, like just
I had some
Lamborghini dealerships.
I had
also there was the recession, and the recession sucked too when you have,
well, so listen to this. So it was a crazy deal because then I had all that stuff happen with all the money things, with all that fraud stuff.
What happened?
So I got a bunch of, like, so this dude out of LA or whatever got my information, whatever, put a bunch of stuff, whatever, I had cars in my name, whatever. So during the time when I was at JGR, it was the most difficult time to even be on that team because they were trying to help me too, but this guy had he had cars on the run, but it was somehow in my name that I've never seen these cars, and they were getting crashed or whatever,
insurance
drugs
jobs.
And dude, this guy's like on the run or whatever with these people, and all they could do is come back towards me, so I might be facing jail time for this fucking dude that went ahead and frauded me. So I was tripping. So
did you know him?
I did. Yeah, back in the day, he got me. He got Ivan. You knew him. Like,
yeah, and I thought he was shady. So,
dude. So at the time, like,
I just went on my gut instinct.
I don't know how he could have got my stuff. Whatever, you know. But
it was fraud.
Yeah,
it was fraud.
But at the time, like,
you were signing stuff.
Bummed. You know, going into racing, besides this whole JGR, like, I couldn't even put stuff together thinking that, like, I'm getting all these calls, like, for something that's so out of my hands that I don't even know what to do.
Yeah.
And literally, I got a couple crazy stories.
I heard that there was a Lamborghini that was somehow in your name that you had never seen or heard of that was found in Mexico, and the seats were gutted because apparently they were stuffed with cocaine.
Yeah, dude, it was insane, dude. I got caught up in this mess, and I was so bummed, dude. I've never, ever been in, like, such a... I'm still, to this day, I'm still dealing with, like, paying off stuff that I had never even seen.
Really?
Yeah, it sucks, dude, and I got screwed, so it really, 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 like... there's a lot more to the story than, oh, yeah, you spent all your money, da-da-da. I mean, yeah, but nah, but... It was just a bunch of shit. So me going racing, it was like, it was so tough, honestly. Like, yeah. I was tripping. And then JGR was trying to help me. They were dealing with it, and they couldn't believe it either. And kind of like when we broke up, they're like, you know, there's a lot of personal stuff going on that you need to figure out. And I was like relieved to be done because I needed more or less to ride a motorcycle. I needed to figure out what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was a little kid that didn't know what everything was falling apart. I was just like, dude, this is insane. More or less trying to have a good head on your shoulders to go race supercross all year.
Yeah. Well, so what are these stories you're talking about?
Dude, yeah, there's just some stuff that's just better off left unsaid.
You know what sucks in our sport that I've seen is at some point, every young kid that's got the best of intentions and might be a little naive, there's always people trying to take advantage of riders in our sport. And then I've dealt with it and I've seen it to other people. And it's really hard because... You don't think someone's, like, out to try and basically get you or fraud you. You know, people, they friend you, they make you feel warm and fuzzy, and you're like, really? He just used me to better himself or invest in something that was a scam that he from the beginning. So it sucks in our sport that it's very hard. You know, a lot of times I tell people the best thing you can do is just get a financial advisor and put it in low risk, low return.
Do it. Yeah, don't that get way, caught up in this.
Just keep it simple and it'll just slowly accumulate and just don't even worry about
Definitely
it.
Definitely don't hook up with a guy into LA who wants to buy Lambos with your credit card.
Yeah.
I don't know, whatever. But at the time, like, I learned to.
Is he in jail now?
I don't know nothing. He'd probably be watching this. I'm probably good. All of us.
I'm pretty sure he's in jail.
Is he?
I'm pretty sure.
I don't know nothing about his whole deal. I haven't seen him since those days.
Since he's been in jail?
Is that what's going down?
I'm 99% sure he went to jail, and I don't know if he's still there. So, but he should
piss?
Be.
I gotta piss so bad. All right.
We can
seconds.
Do our TLD.
We'll do a quick TLD break here.
TLD
we'll
piss
right
break.
Back, right back with more Josh Hansen.
At Nihilo Concepts, we have a passion for innovation and for motocross. Our mission is to develop parts that will improve the durability, functionality, and the appearance of your motorcycle. We're proud to say that everything from Nihilo is made in the USA in our state-of-the-art manufacturing facility in Stuart, Florida. Whether you race every weekend or you just ride for fun, Nihilo offers high-quality, innovative parts that you just won't find anywhere else. Nihilo offers custom engraved engine covers, one-piece titanium foot pegs, brake tips, internal engine components, specialty tools, frame grip tape, carbon fiber components, and so much more. Check out our website, NihiloConcepts.com, and see for yourself why teams like Red Bull KTM, Rockstar Husqvarna, Troy Lee Designs, and some of the fastest riders in the world choose Nihilo Concepts. NihiloConcepts.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. That was your TLD break. And speaking of Troy Lee Designs, we're getting to that part of the year where it's getting hot, humid. Races are going to be down in Florida this weekend. It's going to be muggy. So get on to TroyLeeDesigns.com and check out their new line of vented gear. They've got that air stuff, the summer stuff coming in. Rad new colorways, and the stuff fits great, works great. Keep you cool all summer long. We're back with Josh Hansen. So you were telling us a little bit about this guy that kind of stiffed you, and you were saying over $1 million
yeah
is what it ended up costing you, this guy.
Yeah.
That is insane.
It's definitely some crazy stuff. So there's a lot more to it than just riding dirt bikes. But
I know you said you're still paying off. Are you almost done with that lease?
Yeah.
I mean, at least that'll be some closure. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you just want to be done with dealing with it.
Even, and never even to see any of that stuff or whatnot. But at the end of the day, I'm glad that I'm still able to ride motorcycles. That is what saved my life through all this, you know? Even through bad times or losing everything or what I thought was everything, you know? But now, you know, riding and enjoying it and still being in it, it's honestly a blessing. It's something that I want to be in. It keeps me out of trouble.
Yeah.
Well, I think the thing with something with riding, I noticed even like, you know, now I don't race and I don't ride much. And then you can get caught up with work stuff and just feeling kind of stressed. And you go and ride. And even if your back is stiff the next day and this and that, you feel mentally like you're just in a better mood. Yeah. It's like it does something.
Mototherapy, dude.
Yeah, it helps. And I realize I'm like, I got to get out and do something. Otherwise, I become a grumpy old bastard.
So do you ever feel like you rode, you kind of had a couple shots in that 450 class, once with JGR and then once with Hartney Huntington. But it's like, I feel like you never really got a good chance on a good bike.
Sucks. Yeah, I don't know, but I can only blame myself. I've had good opportunities to obviously make good decisions and to make it happen. So,
but once again, but that was also at a time after the recession. Things were different.
Were tough, yeah.
And, you know, there wasn't a lot of opportunities for people and there wasn't a lot of money in the industry at that time. Yeah. So timing is also a huge part of our sport, and around
I totally forgot that I did have an opportunity when I went to, it was between Troy, and then I remember I didn't do that, so I got hit up by Jeremy McGrath's team.
Oh, the Honda Supercross.
Andrew Short.
Supercross.com or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, and obviously that fell through, but I remember that I took the heart thing over that team because I remember they were going to pay me and only do Supercross only versus Larry Brooks was running it at the time. Mm-hmm. And he said Supercross and outdoors, but it was factory Honda. And I remember Fox wanted to do a deal at the time or whatever. And that would have been what? No, I guess I'm getting ahead of myself. That would have been 2012.
I don't remember what year that was.
Yeah, you're right. It was after Pro Circuit.
That would have been after Pro Circuit. So we haven't got there yet, have we?
Not yet.
All right, sorry, guys.
All right.
Let's cut
it. That's all right. You're going fast. So the other thing I want to talk about, you did 08, you did Supercross and won gold at the X Games.
Yep.
And
did you do Best Whip that year too? Or did they even have Best Whip?
They didn't even have it.
Okay, so in 09 is when they started that, right?
Yeah.
And that's when you were riding for Hart and Huntington.
09, no. 09, I just, yeah, it. That team wasn't that hot, so I just pulled out of riding altogether.
But did you do Best Whip?
No.
You did
Supercross.
It. Oh, no, no.
Supercross.
Okay.
Again, and then I got on Mitch's. I went to Australia. I remember that I got given an opportunity to go to Australia by that Yariv Konski. He's a Honda guy over there.
Okay.
And he hit me up. He's like, hey, I want you to come over here and race. I'm like, I don't race anymore. I was done. I was over it. I was pretty bitter about everything. And he's like, you know, I'll set up a therapist, all this. Like, come and do it. You got too much talent. It was really, like, cool for him to really believe in the situation and kind of peel me off the couch to really do this. And I went over there, and it really helped me out a lot. You know, I had a bunch of issues at the time going on. So I really, like, he got me back up on my feet again, you know, and I wasn't riding that good over there, you know, but I definitely had an opportunity to ride and kind of just get everything going again. Yeah. So I got back to California, and I remember I was like, X Games is in 2 weeks. Are you going to go? And I'm like, I want to do X Games again, you know, like I just won last year. It'd be so sick, but how am I going to pull it together this year, you know, like, I can't go back to Troy. I mean, not that I burned over there, but, like, you know, I didn't sign with this team.
Yeah.
And he's going to be like, I told you so type of deal. So I remember I got hit up randomly. That was when Dirt Shark first got the Monster deal.
Okay.
To go ahead and do the whole situation. Well, he had hit me up. And I remember at the time that company was kind of falling apart with some of the people that had been over there. And they were restructuring all people underneath Monster. Okay. So when Ash, that's Dirt Shark, went into that position, he didn't really have a boss at that time. So they were trying to figure out. So he gave me an opportunity, I remember, to race X Games, or he talked Mitch into letting me ride X Games that weekend. I remember Mitch, I guess, supposedly was like, dude, there's no way I'm touching that kid, you know? And I remember he hit me up, and he's like, hey, he's all, I think Mitch will give you a bike. I'm all, Mitch Payton? I'm like, that would be insane. Like, that'd be so sick for this next weekend. How did you pull that? He's like, you got to be it. You got to get top five, dude. Like, you got to get top five. Like, you can't make me look like an idiot, you know? And I'm like, man, that'd be so cool. He's like, dude, he'll send out, I think it was Paul Parabinos at the time, you know, as a mechanic, and went to the Cowie track for like 3 days, dude. And I rode the 450, and I was just like, oh my gosh, this is such a cool opportunity. So I wanted to win so bad, but I was scared because, dude, I've been on the bike 2-3 times. I don't know. You know, I only get 1 weekend to do this. I get 7 days to pull this off, and then see you later. So I went there, and I remember I was just like, tiptoe, like, man. And Mitch is pretty gnarly on me. I don't know, he was super gnarly on me. I hear he's not that gnarly on other people. He was
probably trying to
dude,
do
guy,
like the JGR thing, which is just
no. And he's good though. Mitch was great. Like, now we'll get back, you know, later on, but him being hard on
he
me
was tough
good.
On you that week.
I just, every, he's always been gnarly. Even when I walk into him now, it's like he keeps me on my toes, and I'm like, hey, it's all good. And I know he's probably like that with everybody, but I feel like it's kind of a little bit harder with me, the way he would talk to me. And like, I love that dude, honestly. Even yeah. Now, he's a great dude. Him and Larry Brooks really did a lot for me as being on a team. But going back to that, I went there, and I ended up actually winning, came from behind. And then I remember, I think it was Wyndham was like, big lead out front, and then cracked it down, and then passed him, won the thing. And then I remember he was so happy, but he told me right afterwards, he's all, I'm not giving you no opportunity. I said, that's fine. Like, thank you for your time. Like, this is sick. You know, I got to do this. I got to win. Like, this badass. Thank you. Went back home. I didn't even bike. I was like, fuck, that was sick. I won today. But I remember I was so screwed on money from all this shit that happened with the cars. I remember I had no money. I didn't even, dude, I just got a phone like a week or two before. I was that broke, and my parents were pissed at me, so I wasn't going to go to them. Like, dude, I was such a shitty situation that yeah. I was like, I remember
didn't
my
you
mom.
You feel like you're on an island by
no,
yourself.
So listen, oh, dude, it was dark times for sure. But then I remember going to the race, and I told my mom I'm going to, you know, race, and it was 50 grand to win at the time. And my mom's like, you better win that race if you think you're going to live and do shit next year. Like, right now, this is it. So I remember going to that race going, I got to win.
No pressure or anything. Jeez.
But, dude, I got to, I like, come on, man. I'm in the negatives. Like, I got to win. I got to get back on my feet again, right? And that was, like, my goal. And I remember, dude, that win was, even though it was only X Games and all that, it was just really cool.
You needed that, huh?
Because in my life during that moment, it was something that I really needed.
Yeah.
And I remember, you know, like, even Wyndham was sick back then. You know what I mean? I mean,
yeah.
Sick now. But I'm saying that was, like, his times that he was really on the podium each weekend. And he, like, I remember it was a good win for me. He had a big lead. I cracked him down, and I pulled away afterwards. And I was, like, I was really proud of that moment in time, even though I didn't get the opportunity afterwards.
So after that race, Mitch, he didn't even – there was no conversation about, man,
nah,
you just
rode
really well.
And then they pulled me back in, and then he told me, hey, I'll give you an opportunity. You know, we're talking about it. And I was like, really? But Monster would have to cover. If Monster wants to do this, I won't. I told you, I'm not helping you. If Monster wants to cover all the bills, then that's on them. And I'm like, all right. Like, I don't know what to say about this. Like, okay, so Monster, I don't really have too much pull here. So Ash, Dirt Shark helped me, like, straight up. Like, he came out and put a deal together. But I remember everybody hung it. Like, I felt like I was hung by my nuts on everything. Like, because I remember Dirt Shark be like, all right, if I give you this opportunity, you owe me. And then it's like, and then Mitch is like, if you do this, then I'm not doing this. You better handle your own shit. You know, it's kind of just like really like, ah, God. Like, all right.
It's like getting pulled in all these directions.
Yeah, like, come on, man. Like, Jesus. Like, all right. So I remember I got the opportunity, but Mitch was like, you're not even a main rider. Like, you, like, Monster wants to cover it. Cool. And I remember he wouldn't even have my bikes prepped. He'd leave them out. So you'd have his race shop inside. And then my bikes would be, like, right outside, you know, by the dyno. And I'm cool, like, whatever. And then he had the dyno.
That's where the
dude.
Customer bikes go,
yeah.
Right?
And then he had the dyno, dude, which was Damon at the time. And he's all, Damon's going to be your mechanic. When he has time, he'll do your bikes. If he doesn't have time, then that's the deal. Remember, you don't ride for me, ride for Monster. I'm like, fuck. All right, cool. So I started going to the track, and I'd be faster than, like, you know, I'd be good. But, I mean, my biggest thing was cardio, and he'd stay on me. And I remember I won some races that year. And then, but I was fast enough to win the championship. I would just crash and just dumb little stuff. And yeah. Weimer ended up winning that year.
What year was that?
10.
Was that the year you broke your hand when you crashed on the whoops? Oh, that was 11,
that
huh?
Was 11.
Was 10 the year you blew somebody out at L.A.? Pretty gnarly in a berm.
Cole Seeley.
It was Cole Seeley. Okay. That's right. Okay, I remember that.
I wanted to win that race. I didn't want to get stuck behind Seeley. I was trying to move him out quick. That was first lap, second lap. I was like, get out. I got to win. I wanted to win.
I
got to
go
so
find
bad.
That. I don't remember that one.
he did it pretty dirty. I remember it because I was managing the team.
That's so why you would remember.
It sticks in my brain.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't. All I wanted to do is win.
Hey, bro, nothing personal, just business.
Yeah. And then, yeah, in 11, I remember you looked like you were on your way to the title. You were riding so well that year.
So when
like you looked like you had it, and then you had a crash in the whoops and broke your hand.
And that was in practice, right?
So 2010, after all that, went and did Australia. So I had a lot of confidence, seeing that I could win. Mm-hmm. My life was getting more together. I was getting a chance. They were going to sign me for 2011. This is cool. I'm going to be on the team this time.
Full season?
Yeah, like okay. 2011. So like okay, cool. So, hey, you're going to go race Australia. Australia is going to have a real supercross series where Dream Tracks was doing the tracks out there, everything. Wyndham was going out there. Brayton was going out there. I think there was a couple other dudes out there at the time. But it was – there was some good guys.
Yeah.
And the tracks were sick. They were really, really, really good. And Monster stood behind it. I remember I went over there, and I won everything over there. Won the championship, and that was a lot of confidence. And I remember I really just told Mitch, I said, okay, I'm coming off the 450. I really want to do 250 East because it'll give me a little time to kind of get in tune, test the bike on a 250. I always have a problem coming from a 450 to 250. It's just different because I short shift the bike. I'm kind of more luggy versus
yeah.
You got to be just so sporadic on a 250. So I get back, and he tells me, you're going to race here in a couple weeks. Or I think I got back at like the last point, and he's like, Dean Wilson just got hurt and you need to race. And I'm like, dude, how are you going to do this? This is like my one year that I know I can win the championship. And I really have this confidence. I'm really trying to prep. I'm like, just give me this time. Nope. You're going to do it. You got to believe in yourself. Roxon's racing. I need somebody to go against Roxon, Eli Tomac. I'm like, all right, well, dude, I just would love, like, more than, like, a couple weeks to really get this show on the road. Like, man, like, I know he's like, you're ready. You just came back from racing. I said, I am. But, you just really want to get your bike. I just want to mentally have it.
Yeah.
It was last minute. We did it, and I actually won the first race. And that was cool. And that was, like, a big, like, that was cool. But I just remember, like, I wanted to keep it going. I wanted to win so bad. And it didn't matter. Like, with Roxon or even Tomac at the time, I was just like, I just remember I'd watch video of them or whatever. I'm like, oh, I'm a better rider than these guys. Like, they may train harder than me, but I'm like, it's going to be on. I can do this better. I'd think crazy stuff, dude, versus, like, say, like, a guy that had cardio or whatever. So I'd, like, pick out different stuff in my mind. I'd be like, all right, this is it, and I'm going to stay this. So I'd go out there and I'd try to win, dude. That was, like, my whole go-to. So I ended up winning the first round. I won the second round. Maybe Dad won the third round, maybe, or maybe I came up short on that. I won both Anaheims, but it started kind of clicking. In 2011, it was badass, and then, well, actually, so the second round at Anaheim is when I crashed and broke my hand. And that just screwed me. Like, I thought it was on, and then.
Yeah, you looked, I mean, you were, like, head and shoulders above everyone that year. I remember just watching you ride, you were, like, confident, you were aggressive.
Yeah.
I remember you thinking you really had it.
I was bummed.
I want to move forward in that season, but first, there was something we didn't touch on. At the X Games, I don't remember the year, but you won Best Whip. What year was that?
That was 13.
Okay, we're not there yet. We'll get to that. I've got that, a video clip of that, because it's the most insane whip I've ever seen still to this day. Okay, so the rest of that year with Mitch, you broke your hand. Was that for Supercross only then, or you were on the whole year?
That was Supercross only.
Okay, and so that was
your year. Yeah.
Yeah, that was definitely a thought, and I still was in it for the championship, but I remember I still won that night after I broke my hand, but as the week set in, it got worse, if that makes any sense.
What bone was it?
It was, I couldn't even tell you what it is.
But just one of your metacarpals.
Yeah, I had a couple right here, and then these two up on top. So whenever they pinned my they pinned them together.
I can see your bent.
Yeah, so they pinned them together. It got pinned, so I couldn't bend my fingers. So they got pinned together for a certain amount of time. So when I would race with my thumb, my middle finger, and I'd use my index finger for everything. And then these were stuck straight up because the pins. So it'd make my, so I'd have to cut my glove. It was such a, I hated it, man. And I was trying to race against Tomac Rocks and trying to lead the, or trying to pull the championship together. And then I had Mitch tell me I'm a pussy and all this. And I'm just like, my God, like, I'm like, I mentally blew it. And dude, Tickle ended up winning because both, I remember Tomac felt like there was problems with him or his bike. And then same thing, Roxon got hurt. And then Tix, dude.
It was a crazy, yeah.
Tix won a mud race and then he was just fourth. And then he won himself a championship.
Yeah. Man, crazy. Now, about this time, you were hanging out in LA a bunch.
Yeah.
And so. You showed, I saw a picture of you with this, and I, Pratt, Stephanie Pratt?
No, dude, I don't know that name.
Okay, well, we have a picture. Why don't we show this photo real quick? Show this picture.
Just friends, right?
Just how friends. In the world were you start hanging out with these people? Like, how did you get connected with them?
I don't know her.
Well, hold on, we'll show her.
You even have your own folder here.
Jesus.
Dude.
Hey, you got the same beanie on, just got rid of the claw.
Yeah.
That's not a bad looking girl. Well, how did you meet this girl? How did you get? And you were hanging out with like Brody Jenner and.
I saw you on the show. I remember now. I saw the show.
Man. Oh, you were on the show.
Yeah, and she went to the track, and he was riding at the Cowie Trust track.
Yeah.
Good old Hattie.
What's going through your head right now when you look at that?
That's funny, dude.
Looks like you're getting table service. See some Red Bulls in the background, some vodka.
He's got bottle service. He's got a little champagne out.
Yeah,
he's,
looks like you might get something else service later that night as well.
Could have been a possibility.
Yeah, just a small one. I got to ask you that.
How did you meet them? How did you get connected into that circle?
It was actually a friend... a friend of a friend. I was at a buddy's house, and then she's like, hey, one of my friends wants to meet you, this and that. She wants to go on a date with you, but don't judge like who she is or this and that. And I'm like, who is she? But I didn't know. I didn't wasn't like familiar with the show.
Yeah.
You know, so I didn't really understand who I was working with, but I definitely had heard of the brother because the brother was kind of loose during that time from who, I just hear about him on the news and shit.
Spencer?
Yeah. Like okay. He was like doing some crazy ass shit at the time. So I've definitely heard of that dude.
Yeah.
Come on, that dude's sister? Well, that's heavy. Like, all right. So I remember I went and hung out with her and it was cool, whatever. But a couple times in, I went out with her and her parents. Like to like a dinner or something.
Okay.
And then at the very end, the dentist like, yeah. So are you gonna do the show, you know, with Stephanie, like the ending, because she needs to find love. And I just remember tripping, like, what? Like,
she I needs was to find love. Yeah.
I was kind of tripping. I'm like, dude, it ain't gonna work. I'm riding for Mitch. Like, nah. Like this, none of this. Like, this is all cool and stuff, but. You don't think
she needs to find love.
No,
on the
it's
show,
like
so
the
it
show.
Like,
the yeah. show. The show's like ending. I don't, dude. It's all scripted. You know. What
yeah.
I mean? So. Yeah. So then the show ended up like calling me that next week, and then I was like, I can't do it or whatever. They thought I would just do it for free or whatever, just to be on it or whatever. And I was over it because I know it's kind of pretty embarrassed to even be on it. More or less, I know Mitch, and then we're not going to be about it. So then they come back, what would it take? And I didn't even know. They came back again, hit me with a figure. And it started getting into figures where I'm like, well, fuck.
Well, why wouldn't you? Yeah.
Like, really?
I love you, honey. Yeah. Yay. Yeah. So we're then, perfect
so
for each
then
other.
I just, like, I went over there and I told them, I'm like, what's, like, told Mitch. And Mitch, at first, was not about it. And then, you know, he kind of helped me use it to my advantage.
How did that conversation go with Mitch?
I don't remember. I
can
couldn't
you,
even
can
be
you imagine?
Clear on
all right,
that.
Listen, Mitch. There's this TV show called The Hills, and yeah. this girl.
Can you imagine? And he's just freaking, dude.
I can't see him being real on board with that.
Nah, and he was already gnarly as it was. So, yeah, walking into that one, I can't imagine was too, yeah, too freaking good. But
so, were you guys legit dating then, or was it just like? For
yeah,
the show.
Like, well, yeah, I went on a few dates, but then she definitely, you know, like, You know, she's happy.
So it was good. So you did date.
Yeah.
Kind of.
I wouldn't, she wasn't my girlfriend.
Right. Well,
and that was a huge thing that she was, that was our biggest problem is like, I just, she wasn't my girl.
You didn't want to commit.
Nah. Like, I was not about committing to any girl.
Yeah.
So I went ahead and we worked it out. I had to show sponsors. If I was going to do it, Monster had to be aboard. Da 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 da. They said, absolutely not. It's a TV show. I said, hey, that's cool. It's not my deal, anyways. They ended up agreeing to it. They ended up going to the Cowie track doing all this stuff. But yeah, it's, it was kind of corny. It was definitely weird.
I never saw the show.
Oh, she was sitting on the tailgate. You guys were talking or something. Dude, I saw it now.
Yeah.
I remember.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Donnie's super fan over there.
No. Just when you hear a motocrosser is going to be on some reality show, you're going to like look it up.
No.
Because I never, that's really.
You're a closet pervert, be honest. You were there for the chicks. You're like, I could drive there.
Yeah. I'm there, dude.
Murrieta's not that far from the Laguna Hills.
So that whole deal happened or whatever, but it's funny because in between that time of us filming, I did like a few of the last shows and a few episodes, and it was, one of them was during the time that I had to be out in Mammoth for Mitch, and I took a big crash during practice. I hit a tree. Dude, I crashed so hard that like I had, most of my skin was like off my body. Like, dude, it was insane. And I remember
hitting a tree up there.
I remember it was down the freeway. I clipped that tree up before that first tabletop. Oh. Dude, I crashed so hard. I landed over that tabletop off the side, and I just remember, like, I don't know. It was insane. I remember I had to fly back to do that show. And Mitch, like, dude, I was, like, just, like, so stiff. And I remember my clothes just sticking to everything.
Oh,
and, like,
I hate that
and
feeling.
Then, and, dude, you do runs of that show. Like, we were on, like, Hollywood Boulevard, like, doing it for, like, I'm
over
talking like they're
over,
closing down like boulevards, like doing it till 4 or 5 in the morning, and I was just sitting there just work, just trying to act like I'm just normal.
Yeah.
Just this work.
There's blood coming through the shirt.
Yeah.
So did you end up making some money off of it then?
Yeah, I made a little money off of it.
That's good.
So it was worth my time. But they just came out with a new one.
Yeah.
Now they're trying to do it, and I just got hit by actually Brody not that long ago about this whole new one, but I don't know the whole lefts and rights. Like, they're trying to restart it or something.
So someone's looking for love. They need to call Hanny.
Yeah,
it's Brody's dad. He's looking for love.
He's staying out of this combo right now.
He's looking in all the wrong places.
Hey, he's not. I heard that he got no Father's Day card this year, though.
Yeah, I doubt it.
Oh,
shit. On to the next one.
So how did you meet Brody? He was just part of that crew?
He knew about motocross or whatever. And
he's
been
coming for
me
a while, though. Yeah, like, he used to come with Malcolm McCassie. I met him years ago
at
MotoGP.
Like, hotel. I was randomly there for maybe a Monster thing or something. And he just randomly came up and he's like, come bowling, this and that. And then, I met him. And then even like... what's that guy? It would be his brother-in-law, but I forget his name. It would be Kardashian.
Oh, the douche lord dude.
Yeah. Disick.
Scott Disick.
And then that dude would start trying to come to the track and stuff. He like went and bought a lifted truck from J-Star. He went and got a Honda.
He showed up at the Supercrosses. Was hanging out in like some of the team trucks, I remember, that year.
And then he started he'd go out to Star West all the time. He's funny, dude. And then, I don't know, I didn't really... just kind of landed on my lap, all that stuff.
Yeah, sometimes one thing leads to another.
Yeah, it wasn't like I was like trying to get into it. I didn't know what the hell was going on. I was definitely trying to look for chicks at the time.
So you've always been looking for chicks. Yeah. That's kind of like right up there on your priority list.
That was,
And you know what? Of all
Winning
the people
races,
I know.
Smashing pussy, right?
Hey, of all the people I know in this sport, this dude pulls them like good ones, like tens.
I don't know about
left
all that.
And right. There's something about you. I don't know what it is.
About all that.
How about,
dude?
I want to know about. I want. What I want to know about. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I wanted to know. Actually, is Holly Madison?
Yeah. What about it?
I know you hung out with her. Tell me more. I remember watching. What was the show now?
Oh, with Hugh Hefner.
Yeah. I'm drawing a blank. What
Girls
was it?
Next. Girls Next Door.
Oh, that's right.
Girls Next Door. Yeah.
And I was. She was always my favorite. So I'm a little jealous.
Yeah, that one kind of landed on the lap, too. I was just at a bar. Like,
was she clothed or not clothed, and she landed on your lap?
The first time?
Hey.
Minimalistic, right?
yeah.
You don't kiss and tell?
No,
but I just mean, answer. Like, I'm sure a lot of guys out there would be pumped to know. Did you hook up with her?
Dude, you if you're gonna hang out with a chick, I mean, I hope that you try to. All smash, right,
there we go.
Right, like what are we doing?
Hanny smashes cheeks. That's what he does.
Street cred.
Right. Hey, but yeah, and I remember. Hey, I remember like I was sitting at a bar with one of my buddies, just like randomly during the day, and he's like, "Hey, again, like one of my friends wants to hook up," and I was like, "Yeah, I would run." Dude, that thing looks beat right there. That thing looks kind of worked.
That's not a good picture.
That's not a great picture.
That's a worked pick.
Looks like she was out at the pool.
I mean,
too long.
I don't know. Is she even that? I mean, she's. It's cool that she was on the show and shit, but she ain't like super gnarly hot.
No,
I don't know. All right.
Depends who you ask, I guess.
No, so yeah, like so he tells me who it is. I'm like, yeah, for sure. I'm like, this is a good chance.
Is that the best picture you had, Donnie?
So you just.
I said
that's all
you'd find. I'd say I'd run it for sure, in all respect. Yeah, I was like, it's a done deal. Yeah, so
I would have been disappointed.
So I remember
if
the
you
first.
Didn't.
So the first. So my buddy dated her assistant. That's how this even happened.
Okay.
Angel at the time, and then I remember she was like, "Yeah, they want to go on a date, but she's all into Disneyland." That's like she's big, like that's her life is Disney shit, like Disney character shit. I don't know. So
did you dress up as Goofy?
No. That'd be so bad.
Come in like, guess what, honey? We're doing a doggy style.
No. Didn't happen like that at Disneyland. But
so you'd met her at Disneyland and had a date.
Yeah, so then like all like there was like press there and
I would have loved to see
yeah,
that.
Yeah, so we showed up. I showed up and then there was press people there, and she's like had this person that was just taking us around, so we skipped all these lines and didn't deal with people.
Dude, that's like worth $3,500 a day.
That's worth dating her right there, yeah. Skipping the lines at Disneyland.
Okay, so
I would take it for
so
that
we did
deal
all
alone.
That, and then she had a room there at the hotel, and like, but I mean, what was I to
You're
do?
Like, this is the happiest place in the world. Yeah, I gotta.
That was my first time going to. I remember Disneyland, like remembering as before a little kid, before now taking my kid now. So I've always. Known that place for being good. Seriously, like
most people are like, yeah, I got mixed feelings about Disneyland. Hanny's like, it is the happiest place on earth. I proved it.
So did you guys hang out more after that, or was it just kind of one day and then
I think I hung out with her one more time, but yeah, no, it was pretty short-lived. And then she met that dude that she ended up marrying and had
a Vegas guy.
Yeah,
isn't he like Steve Wynn's?
I don't know, he has huge money, he puts on all yeah. those music festivals and stuff.
Yeah, yeah,
EDM or something. EDU. EDM?
Wow, EDM, yeah.
EDM.
That's...
But was it... It's got to be a little bit awkward even just trying to have a normal relationship with someone like
I
that.
I never had no relationship
you know, but
with
I mean,
so
like,
I don't know.
Most people, if they go on a date, it's you
what,
and them.
What do you talk about? Like, with this girl...
I remember it was a little weird. I remember some weird shit. I don't know. I just remember I was trying to run. I didn't really, like... I was like, dude, I don't know. What am I going to say to her? Like, I can't talk, like, fucking... Playboy Mansion with her. I can't talk. I mean, I could ask a lot of questions. I can't talk no fashion. I mean,
what are you going to talk about? That's what I'm saying.
I
like,
don't remember at the time, but we made it work. A couple whiskey cokes went down the throat, and everything was good. I don't know. I'd be
loosen
lying
up.
If I said something, but
some,
it all
some
worked
other stuff
out.
Went down. Anyway,
that's good, man.
Well, good for you.
Yes,
that's it's an impressive roster. Let's get back into some dirt bikes. I want to see this best whip video. So
heavy, huh?
To this day, I have truly not ever seen a whip like this. And it was kind of at the end of the run. And you were, dude, you're upside down and backwards. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And you're riding a Suzuki. Was that an H&H bike? Or how
no,
did you?
Just a stalker.
Just a stalker? Do you remember this jump? Like, did it just, everything clicked right? Or what happened?
Well, I just remember, like, that jump sucked. It didn't have good lip, and it was short.
That one.
So I had to, and they did a side angle, so it doesn't look that big right there.
No, dude, it's ridiculous.
The biggest thing is, like...
Watch this right here. Hold on, you got to go back. He did a little...
That was...
This one.
Bro.
I mean, you're upside down, dude.
Yeah.
There was a picture. Someone did a win ad or something in the magazine, and someone caught it at a pretty good angle, and it was like, I remember, I was like, holy shit.
Which way is he going?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's insane. Yeah. To this day, I've not ever seen a whip like that.
That was cool. Yeah, that was exciting times. I remember like the Twitter thing and the vote, and I didn't really have that many followers to be able to go off of, and I had to at least make my. I guess I'd have to at least make my riding like speak for itself, because you know I
42%.
It wasn't even close. Twitch has got some, but man, she's getting the Vicky's getting the female vote.
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, poor Nate Adams just got screwed.
Were you? I mean, when you pulled that, were you like, whoa? That was it. Sketchy. Yeah, were you ever like,
scary.
Oh man?
It was scary because I really had to yank hard.
You just got it back.
Yeah,
and the landing and was slick. If you landed sideways, you were gonna wash out.
It was super slick, and the berm was right afterwards, so you had to really hit the brake. And I went a little bit far, which was good. That's what saved me, because if I would have came up a little bit shorter, it would have been dirty.
Yeah, you land right at the bottom of the landing.
Right at the bottom, so it worked out perfect.
I mean, look at that. You are literally
a good angle, though. It would be good if it was from behind, because then you could see how upside down you are. Like, right there, it just almost looks like a normal whip.
I don't even think my body would bend enough.
No, dude, you look like you're upside down and backwards.
Yeah, no, that thing definitely was big, and it was clean. It wasn't all jittery.
Yeah, that was the thing, too. When you landed, I knew it was everything to get it back, but it looked so
And you claimed perfect. It. You knew. Like, when you went in the berm, you're
sick.
Like...
I was like, even if you didn't win, it was
At least you could have said I had the best whip.
That was cool.
Win or lose, yeah.
Yeah, that was fun, but I definitely landed a little deep on that one.
Well.
A little bit.
I think you did the same thing with Holly.
Yeah,
that's why I keep saying it looks better from behind. I swear, there's a better shot from behind.
All right, moving along. What else?
I thought this is a Moto show.
You got any good stories down at your time in LA and hanging out with all them?
Nah.
Yeah, he's got a few. I bet.
I've had a lot of good times. I mean, but
best story? You got a good best story?
Man. She's
I feel like it's hard sometimes for people to pull out that one.
Yeah, well, I know. We kind of put you on the spot. All right, so tell me this story then. Because you really tried to cover this up for a long time, the scar.
Yeah.
Oh, I crashed on my BMX bike, and I'm looking going,
Mitch told me to say, go with that.
What happened? Tell me about that. I know it was a fight in a barn. It was a glass, right? Or something, yeah. Or a bottle.
So I ended up getting my Mitch deal. I was stoked. I mean, everything was cool. I remember started whatever it was, went to the gym for, I don't know, just got done. I remember I was.
This is 11?
What's that?
2011?
No, this would have been maybe before that. Yeah, maybe it was.
Okay.
Something like
that. We're between 10
yeah.
and 11.
So when I walked in there, whatever, but it was during the day. It wasn't at night. Even it was right before dark, but I was meeting a friend that had came from California that was staying nearby.
Okay.
Right there in Newport. And the Little Night, if you guys know that spot.
The Little Night?
The Little Fight. It's a dive bar. It's a rocker dive bar. It's a rad spot. And I remember I went in there and I still had my gym clothes on or whatever. And I just had walked in there and I was waiting for my buddy. And I know one of the bartenders, he rides dirt bikes, whatever. And literally was in there for 2 seconds. And this guy was getting gnarly with this chick, dude. Gnarly, dude. And somebody said stop or whatever. I don't know. Anyways, it wasn't even my deal. The guy had must came back in, and I went back talking to the guy about motorcycles. And dude, he had a mug, like a frozen glass mug, and went behind me and hit me. But I don't know if he thought I was somebody else or what.
Oh, so you weren't even involved?
I hadn't even gotten involved. Like, this thing caught me so off guard, dude. But it didn't even knock me out, is the crazy part. It just filleted open my whole face, and I didn't know at the time. Because right when I got hit, I was like, okay, we're fighting. So it got down, and I tried, fighting him as hard as I could.
Did you whack him at this? Did you get a good shot?
I remember people grab me off of him, and I remember everybody started screaming because my face was hanging off, and I didn't realize.
Like bad?
It was bad. Which we got a picture of that too. It's gnarly.
You do?
You don't need to pull it up. Yeah, no, it's definitely on there. It's hanging. So I remember when I got up, it was just a wrong place at the wrong time. I was so bummed. And then, obviously, Mitch is really big on, hey, you're not going to do the fighting thing. You're not going to be that guy. And that was, as you should, we're turning a new leaf and stuff. And then now I got to go back and tell him this. Like, he ain't going to believe me, you know? I remember he was so mad, and he was going to call. I had to give him the bars, and I was like, really? You know, they have it all. The police had to come, so they had to do
police reports.
And the whole because they had surveillance.
Did the guy stay? Like, did they catch him?
They had to keep him to stay, yeah, because they ended up taking him or whatever, and not me. But, like, when the guy walked in, I was like, I really didn't do nothing. They're like, no, this does not happen just from nobody doing anything. I'm like, okay, well, luckily they had cameras. So they went over everything and seen everything. And I just, like, that was a good thing. But to deal with Mitch after that, dude, I came in and I had to get, like, man, like 60, 70 something, like a stitch in my face or something like that. So when I came back in, I was like talking to him and he was pissed, threatening me and all this. And then I had to give him the cop information and give him all that. And he looked into it and realized it really wasn't my fault, but it was fucked. So he knows that he put out a chance on me to put me on his team to get my life together. And then now this, it really pissed him off. So then he's like, you can't say it. You, like, I remember I was supposed to race Monster Cup and I couldn't even put on a helmet. Because I had stitches through my eyebrow, right down here, and through my whole face. And I couldn't put on my...
Yeah.
So I didn't even ride up to it. And he's like, you're going to have to tough it out. But you do press today. You're telling him a BMX. And I just do... My face was so fucked.
I'm only laughing just the way you said it.
Well, when it first happened, you can hardly see it now. Yeah. Like, when you first did it, dude, it was...
It was gnarly.
It was gnarly.
Yeah. It was gnarly for sure.
That BMX jump must have been fucking big.
It got me good.
All right, so you took a couple years off. I guess it would be 13 and 14?
Yeah.
Like, you're just off the map. You didn't do any Supercross, any Nationals. Nah. What were you doing?
Nah, I literally, I got kicked out of Supercross for rough riding.
With H&H, or yep. No,
what was I? No, so I didn't have
a Didn't you a get deal. In trouble in Frisco for something?
No, that was your dude. That was the French dude, Boniface, when he kept cross-jumping.
That's right.
I know, you can't say that, dude.
All right, I barely remember. I'm just trying to pull up little things. All right, so where did you get in trouble?
No, I got in trouble at, where are we at? What year right now?
2012.
2012.
God, dude.
The last time you got in trouble.
Yeah, I ended up... Jeff Ward Racing was down. The owner had called me that week of and said, hey, if you wanted to race this weekend, we have a bike or whatever. And so I went out there, and rough riding got me kicked out. So that's where that ended everything.
Was it with Boniface, the rough riding?
No, it was with Alex Ray.
Oh, that's right. You broke his knee brace. Didn't you break his knee brace or something? Yeah. I remember hearing about that.
So that happened, and then they kicked me out, and I was kind of okay.
They kicked you out. They just said,
you're done. You're done. Gallagher, I've had the worst problems with Gallagher, no matter if being good or not. Like,
I don't think you're the only one.
Man, he's tough on me. He's a big reason why I don't even want to do it too much, because I'm already having problems no matter what. Stepping in, you just get those people that have a chip on their shoulder, and that's it. Like, I come walk in there, and you're just like, he'll talk to me before practice even comes out. Like, you get it. It's like, really?
I have noticed, and I know John personally, and I think he's a decent guy, but when it comes to officiating, I almost feel like he's handled different people differently. Like, if it's someone that's like the good kid, or like if Villapoto did something, it was kind of swept under the rug. But if it was Tyler Bowers, or
it's a little bit more,
Someone that's maybe been in a battle taking someone out before, there's like a zero tolerance kind of thing. Like, it's overboard. You're like, but wait a minute. When that guy did it, he got a warning, you know, or something. It's like, be consistent. Don't go, oh, well, you know, it's like if there's a troublemaker, just jump into the assumption it's that guy. You know, people just can't jump to that assumption. Maybe.
Yeah, that whole deal is kind of rough. You know?
But to be kicked out of the sport because you hit someone, to me, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. And I was told by my dad to go to anger management and stuff like that. It was crazy.
Did you tell him to watch the movie? The people telling you go to anger management, need it more?
So I remember after that, my dad was really mad, 2013, and he's like, well, okay, so it's done now. It's finished. How many times are you going to come back and do this? And I'm like, it ain't done. I was like, I'm going to go do X Games. No.
Because at this point, you're like almost turning 30, right?
Yeah. So I said, no, what I've been? No, 28, 29, whatever. Anyway,
yeah,
so
you're heading to 30, which is
so long story short, like, yeah, there wasn't too many opportunities at that time. And then since I was kicked out, I couldn't race. So I'm like, all right, well, nobody was doing free. I mean, people free rode, but you know, like when you guys all did it or whatever, but there was no such thing as a free rider, like really like making money at doing any of it, or racers doing X Games at the time or not. So I ended up on 2013. I remember sitting on the couch with my mom and dad, and he was pissed. I'm like, I'm going to try to put video stuff together or whatever. I'm going to try to get into doing X Games. He's like, you're an idiot. Like, you're not going to make any money. Like, how are you going to do that? You know, these guys have been doing it for years. You're going to do freestyle. I was like, I can do freestyle. I was like, I don't want to do freestyle. But I was like, they have best whip. They have step up. I mean, I can do that stuff. So he was pissed.
Like, your dad was?
Yeah, because nobody was doing it. There's no Tyler Biermans, Axel Hodges.
Well, that's pretty much what Twitch is now.
McNeil's. I don't know. They like, I was solo mission doing this, you know, like kind of coming into it, trying to like build it. So I leaned on Twitch, you know. Twitch is the freestyle guy going to do an X Games. I say, hey, I want to do X Games. Kind of laughs like, well, what are you going to do? I'm like, let's do best whip. He's like, you think you can do it? I was like, I'll figure this shit out. You know, I feel like I'm a good enough rider. I could do this, you know? So went out there, and then, you know, I did my first year, I won gold, so that was sick. And then I started making more money just doing my X Games stuff than I did even racing. So I ended up bringing in, and I was kicked out. So then I kind of went down that road, and then I don't know, now I just kind of just kept transferring. And then now I think it's been cool because it's kind of turned a different page in for riders to keep doing stuff that maybe, you know, were racing before that are trying to keep riding going, because at the time, there was no
problem. It's also, like you said, I think it's also a mindset. You know, in our sport for a while, it was starting to get serious. So if you weren't serious, you weren't considered an athlete or a racer. But there's a whole new avenue. But because it was fresh, people didn't see it. I'll be honest, I didn't really think, like, free riding would become sort of its sport of its own or a business. And then you go, oh, well, I get it. Yeah, but everyone's online. Everyone wants videos. Everyone wants content. That's the day and age we live at. Give them good content. There's money to be made out there. Yeah.
And snowboarders do it. Skaters do it. Bicycle guys do it.
I think it's rad. I think it's super cool because it gives a different avenue. And I think it brings up, so when people want to be involved that, like, you know, that maybe can't race, that maybe can
just
can
have
just
fun.
Have fun. They can. They have a different avenue to go around. But for me, it was expressing riding dirt bikes. And then I got lucky to be able to do X Games and being able to start doing well right off the bat. And it was like, this is cool. So I definitely enjoy the racing part, but when it comes down to the Gallaghers and stuff, and like, then you're like, man, I enjoy riding dirt bikes a lot.
Yeah.
It's a catch 22, but you gotta, it's hard to make money these days. So it's really like you
go down one path or the other now.
You either gotta shit or get off the pot. Like, it's either like, what are you gonna do?
Yeah.
You came back in 15, 16, 17, you rode 250, 450, and then 250 again. What were those years about?
15, I did my own team.
That was Living 100.
Yeah.
Okay.
I told myself, I'm going to come back race. And people are like, I remember I called Dang that did Lawrence's team stuff. I'm like, what do you think? He's like, you're wasting your time. You'll never, ever pull it. I remember I hit up Chad. You know, he was doing his team. He's like, you'll never, ever pull it. You know, he's like, you know, you don't even want to. And I remember it was kind of like a defeat of mine. I was like, oh, they don't, you know, I can get money. And I actually put together a really cool situation, but it was with motorsport. But it was tough to be able to put a 250 program, to come off of everything, to have people take you serious, to have a good team and not just some, just to make it look good, but to actually have good bikes and good staff and stuff. Like, I really took pride in my stuff. And it was tough, though. Yeah. And then I had my kid the same year. It was a big defeat of its own, like, just to race and try to put everything together and stand by your word. And you're only as good as your word in this sport.
Yeah.
Did having your daughter change you at that moment?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. You want to do the very best you can. Like,
I think it always changes people. I guess what I'm trying to say, did it change your mindset and your outlook at motocross? Some guys say they're worried about getting injured, or their focus shifted, or they knew it was time to give it, like, any of those?
I guess it didn't really set in as much as, like, now, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I couldn't even believe I had the same thing. Like, more or less having a team at that time, or everything was just kind of like, wow, like, it was all in one. It was hard to balance, but it was cool. So that was 15. 16, what happened 16? 16, I rode a 450.
Yeah.
What was the 450 thing, though? I remember I just showed up because the hell happened? I got to remember. I don't know, but I remember in my contract with Cali or something, I said I'd show up and race a race, and I showed up to Santa Clara Supercross, and I qualified out of the heat race, and then I was doing all right. I was just in like a 10-way battle between Blake Baggett. That was when he was factory Suzuki. Mm-hmm. I remember because I wasn't in the best of shape. I could go good, if not faster, but like when it started kind of getting down, it was me, Barsha, him, Alessi was somehow in the mix because he had gotten a start.
He's doing his look backs
and doing all this. Josh Grant. I just remember coming out of Supercross going, are you joking me? Hey, Santa Clara and all that. And the track was kind of gnarly. And uh-huh. I was just getting tired as hell. I'm like, Jesus. But yeah, I did that. I think I got like 14th. I ended up crashing or whatever. And then, dude, I've had weird years. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I feel like, because every time I talk to you about kind of racing and your career, you know, what you've accomplished, I feel like you are comparing yourself to your dad. Mm. Do you feel like you have this chip on your shoulder where you have to live up to his expectation or live up to what he accomplished or something like that? Because that's what it seems like from the outside looking in.
No, I don't know. I mean, I just really feel that I just really feel that I do believe in myself as a good rider, and I do believe that, you know, that I feel personally that it should have went a different way, you know, in certain areas. So that's my own fault. It's nobody else's. I mean, that's just something personally for myself. I can't say it's because of my dad or anything, but I've been given a golden opportunity. So it's like, you know, I don't know. Maybe I can't express it in championships. I mean, yeah, I've won X Games. I've won, like, say, world races and title, like, you know, the other series. But I don't know.
But you don't ever feel like there's this expectation to live up to your dad that you didn't achieve, and that holds you down or bogs you down?
No. Because
it seems that way.
It's more personal. It's more personal. I don't know. That's why I still ride, though, now. Like, it really does. There's people that do it. I think at first I was really trying to be like, oh, wow, this is so cool, and thinking you're, like, famous and dirt bikes. And, dude, it's pretty funny now looking at it because – I've really changed that a lot, like, in my perspective, like, looking at all this stuff. It's not what it seems, you know? Like, us thinking we're big names and all that. Yeah, we are in the sport. But
it's tiny, though.
Mm. Yeah, it is. And, you know, you think that you're, like, a basketball player or something, you know, doing it. And at the end of the day, it's like, you got to love motorcycles for what it is. And a lot of people live on who they are as a rider than who they are as a person. And I used to be that. You know, you get your confidence and you talk and you're doing certain things and you're a certain way and you act like this is like a lifestyle. It comes with confidence, and really to stay like humble and to stay on the right path and be honest with yourself is two different things.
Hmm. For sure. Like, I know I've said it before.
So that's why I don't give a lot of respect to my whole career. Yeah, that's cool. I've won a lot of races. That's cool. I've done this and that, but you shit or you get off the pot. And again, it's called black or white. There's a lot of shade of gray in that.
Yeah. Yeah, but at the end of the day, you know, you got to just look at what you did and be like, all right, well, I'm proud of what I accomplished.
Yeah,
cool. There's stuff I didn't accomplish, but it's like he said, guys who've won championships, they still wanted to win more. I should have won that one. I wish I could have won this. You know.
Yeah, I guess you never, ever be. It's just like saying, oh, I'd like to live over there. I'd like to live over here. You always think the grass is greener, but I don't know. I mean, dude, I you got to understand, my grandpa invented plastic for dirt bikes.
That's crazy.
So I'm in, like, so I got my grandpa on my birth mom's side, and I got my dad, and they're both in the Hall of Fame. So, yeah, you would like to definitely step up, you know? You definitely want to step up and do, and especially, like, I do feel like I do have a lot of talent to do a lot of cool things on dirt bikes and not have to get the certain angles or certain this or have cool hair. I want it to be seen for itself and the raw of dirt bikes and the goodness that comes out of it. If it's to be with family, if it's to bring you closer, if it's to get you off, say, the streets of doing bad stuff to whatever. There's so much goodness to come out of this, you know? So I still keep carrying it on. Maybe I didn't do what I wanted to, but I don't want to close the pages. Like, I genuinely love riding dirt bikes.
Yeah, and there's no reason.
And you're good at it. So
yeah, there's no reason you should.
I would say to you, keep going.
Yeah,
I mean, at least now, I mean, I've seen
you got to deal with Honda and testing Showa and all that. Tell us, how's that? Is it gratifying at least? Are you still having fun being out there?
I love it.
Because I know it's funny, testing kind of sucked for a lot of people at one point. I kind of get a little kick out of testing because I enjoy making things better, or at least trying to. Do you enjoy it a little bit more now?
Yeah, I do. I think basically being around people. I the Honda thing really caught me off guard to even be able to get that situation. That really kind of wasn't expecting that. So to be able to test with these guys and to really get in tuned and being close now with Kenny and stuff, it's cool because I genuinely want to do good for them. Mm-hmm. You know, and try to be the best as I can to try to help or whatever and give good advice, even if it's for Kenny or whatever. Yeah, I mean, he's gnarly, but he's young. He can still learn. You can always learn for somebody that did this or did that or whatever position they're
anyone in. Smart enough, even if you're at the top, there's always someone doing something better than you. Yeah. Guaranteed.
And I think just being around, like, even, like, Eric Kehoe and Sam and just, like, a few guys and Lars over there, those guys are just super, super good people. And I really think that they love motorcycles just like me.
Yeah.
I genuinely love motorcycles. Like, I would like to be a part of it if I'm riding or not. It's just, it's something that I feel like that's part of my life.
Yeah.
So I got lucky with that whole Honda situation, and testing has really kept me going and given me a new opportunity I didn't expect, and it's helping me learn more too. I'm excited to learn more stuff, even about new bikes or if I can even help. I mean, it's so important that an OEM bike is good, and I want to get involved in maybe future stuff. And I don't know.
There's always going to be a need for that in our sport. You know, so I try to tell people, dirt bikes is what we all grew up and what we know. You're a journalist, I'm an announcer, I have a dealership, you're testing, we're all involved in the sport. So if you can still find something that you enjoy that there's a need for, maximize it.
Yeah.
And I think that's pretty cool that there's not a lot of guys making a living testing in our sport. And I also do believe it's something, like you said, that the sport does need.
Yeah.
Is the continuous.
I think it's good. I mean, you get the kids that come in and they're getting thrown into this whole mix. And I really do believe that a lot of people, certain people don't have maybe, you know, they you know, I don't want to say a good feel of the bike in some areas. Like, they'll set up the bike and it's so backwards.
Some guys
and
don't
it's like,
know how to.
At least maybe help us maybe genuinely, like, get a general area set up and then they can kind of go off of that. At least it being in a ballpark.
Well, sometimes if you can
maybe
simplify.
Maybe take away trying to chase everything and
exactly.
Not knowing where you're going.
Give them a couple simple different settings. At least if a guy's not good at testing, he can go, that felt better than that.
Yeah.
Now they go, okay, hey, Hanny, we need this done. We're moving in this direction. And there's a lot of riders that struggle with testing.
Yeah. Mm. I think it's super big because just getting it in the general area, I mean, trying to make it perfect for somebody. I mean, at the end of the day, any rider's got to understand that the track changes every lap. This is dirt bike racing. So for you to have a perfect bike out there, you're not going to find anything perfect. It's getting it within the ballpark and feeling comfortable and being able to work around your needs.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Do you see that? Where do you see that going down the road?
I don't really know, man. I'm not really putting a whole thing. Like I said, I want to do more video stuff. The reason why I haven't been putting out, like, rad videos is I need to get a sponsor to really push, or maybe just I want to get somebody to pay for a filmer. Hmm. I'm not one of those guys that's trying to be in front of my phone all day and trying to get, like, some fake shot or make it look better than what it is. I want somebody. I want
to
be
there. Hear it. Hanny needs a sponsor. So yeah,
just for my videos, man. I'll plug you guys, whatever. But I definitely want to show, like, you know, motorcycle rad stuff. You know, it isn't about going for 500-foot jumps. It can be about anything. It's about riding dirt bikes, and that's what I'd like to show. And I feel like I can do pretty good at that. So that's where I see myself always kind of going and then doing my Living 100 brand. And I got some other stuff I've been working on.
Okay.
So we'll see what happens.
What's the website for the Living 100 stuff?
LVN100.com, or you can go to JoshHansen100.com. Kind of ties into both, but I'm trying to, you know, start getting that kind of going, and then so it's cool.
Cool. How's your daughter? She's 4, you said?
4 years old, yeah.
It's life-changing stuff, huh?
Yeah, it is. It goes by too quick.
Yeah.
It's a happy, sad deal.
Now, are you still close with mom?
Yeah, we do the whole back and forth thing, you know, like
there's no working it out with her, like getting together.
No. We're together, then we have our times where we're not, you know. It kind of just, it's a hard thing.
Yeah. That's pretty common.
Well, sometimes I think it's almost like if it's not
perfect, it's one thing. But then when you have a kid involved, you kind of want to make it work.
You always want to make it work with the mom. I mean, dude, it's an important thing, you know. And she's a good mom, so that's the you know, the biggest thing. You always want the best. And
yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I always want it to work out with her.
Yeah, but and if you can't, you at least need to be on good terms.
Yeah, if you guys know that already, absolutely. You definitely need to figure stuff out. And that's way harder than I feel like a championship is trying to figure this one out.
I'm thinking,
yo, my championship?
There's no manual for
what
it.
What are we doing with the kid, though?
Yeah. Well, there's no manual.
Jeez, I know. There's so many ways you can go and make so many mistakes. And, dude, this is a human. This isn't something that you look back on and go, oh, well.
This is
a PCU. You want everything. Your job is to make it better for your little one than what you had, you know? So it's like, I want to.
Exactly.
I don't want to, like, have her fail for my stupidity.
Yeah. Well, and so I doubt it.
We ask everybody that comes on here, and we're going to ask you to appear before we go, is how do you want to be remembered? Or what kind of legacy do you want to leave? And it's like, you know, something that I think really applies to you and guys like me who got a couple number two plates hanging on our wall.
Yeah.
Is that shit goes away. All right? It doesn't matter. You go ask a young kid racing today who Jeff Stanton is.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
They don't know.
Isn't that crazy?
They don't know who these guys are. And that... You're in the record books, and that's cool, but your legacy is going to be left with your children and their children and what your kids tell them about you, right? And the person that you were, the things that you did with them. That's your legacy. And I try to get people to see that, kind of take that perspective because, man, dirt bikes or what you did on a bike, it's cool, but it goes away. You know, it fades and no one will really remember. That doesn't resonate.
Yeah.
It's not like... Your daughter's going to go, oh, yeah, my dad was a, you know, 2-time X Game champion and blah, 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 blah. You know what I mean? The things that you do with her, the way that you raise her, the relationship that you have, that's your legacy.
Yeah.
Because that's what she'll share with her kids, right?
Yeah.
So, anyway, I just try to let that other stuff go. At least that's what helped me because I was really had a hard time letting go of the couple of championships that I lost by a couple points. And it's like you get to a point where you just realize that stuff doesn't even matter.
Yeah.
In the grand scheme of things. Yeah. And it's really hard to see it in the moment because from the time we're three in your case, it's like all you cared about.
Yeah. And then as you get older, your cares, wants and needs change as well. I mean, like for me, I got kids that are teenagers and
it's crazy. That trips me out.
I know. And it's like, times I'm still that teenager at heart, yeah. But now we can go and play and do stuff together. And I'm like, it's like a release. Like I can be a kid and I have an excuse now. Yeah. But we have a great relationship and you know, I'm divorced, you know, Chelsea and that, but we've worked it out, had a pretty good friendship now, and then I think it's good for the kids. So the kids will look up their parents, and I think you'll do a good job, Hanny. Yeah, I have faith in you.
I try. All you can do all is do what you can.
I know some people might doubt you, but someone like myself who knows you, you'll figure it out. You're a smart kid.
Yeah, I agree.
I say kid. You're not a kid anymore.
All right. So last question then. How do you want to be remembered?
Just as a good person, a man of his word.
Solid.
Short and sweet.
That's it. I mean, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, if anything else carries over, like as far as like riding or whatever, that's awesome. But I don't know. Yeah.
Well, hopefully we'll get to see some of your videos.
Hey, Donnie, can you pull up that picture I sent you? I got a picture I sent him. This is your doppelganger. Do you know who I'm going to throw up here right now? Do you know who he looks like? An actor.
No.
You know who it is, huh?
Dude.
That's my brain dead on the dude's name. But yeah, I know who you're talking about.
An actor. I'm trying to
Every
think
time
that.
I see this guy, I'm like, God, that's Hanny. It looks just like you.
What's his name? He's off of the Pineapple Express.
James Franco.
James Franco.
Yeah, hopefully he pulls it up here in a second. Producer Donnie. Oh, he's totally off the rails over here. There's Hanny. There's Hanny's X Games gold.
Metal Militia.
TLD. Lip ring. Where's that thing at?
Sick. I don't know. I swallowed it.
Look at young Hanny, man.
Jeez. You've always kind of had the same hair, though.
I know.
Oh, there's your... That was. Oh, no. Nope. Nope.
He's got the
It's
full
the most
paparazzi.
Recent one. Oh, well, anyway.
204. Like that was a rookie number.
I like
that.
How you guys like pull up and everything's all paparazzi, paparazzi, and then you got like a couple racing ones. What is this?
Don't look at me.
Well, anyway. I just Google image search Josh Hansen. Bam, that's what comes up.
I was going to say, and usually it's those ones around celebrities that will pop up first.
Yeah. Anyway. Well, hey, thanks for coming on, bud. I think you have an awesome story.
Man. I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
You know, you're buddies with both of us, and you had a cool story.
That's cool, thanks.
And I'm glad you came on and shared it with us.
Appreciate it.
And it was fun getting to race you for a bit.
That was cool.
And I was sorry to be that awesome dick that ruined it for you. But
you
anyway.
Guys are the legends, though. I look up to you guys, you know? You guys are my dudes when I come into the sport, so it's cool.
Well, we appreciate you coming on, man.
It's all good. Thanks.
See you at the dirt bike track.
Thanks, Annie.
Thanks.
All right, we'll be right back to wrap up the Whiskey Throttle Show. That was Josh Hansen.
WP is more than a store. We're truck and Jeep experts. From wheel and tire upgrades to full custom builds, 4WP has you covered. Do your rig right. Shop online or find your store at 4WP.com.
Everybody, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. We finished up there with Josh Hansen, and that was a good chat with him. He's a, I think, pretty misunderstood kid.
Took the words out of my mouth.
But a really nice, good guy. Like, he's got a good heart inside, you know. And
I always have a lot of time for people that have a good heart, and Hanny's one of the good guys. And you can tell he's had a little up and down, some frustrations, and it's one of the things that I love about the show is we're able to help people understand a little more of, oh, maybe he didn't just blow all his money. Maybe there was more to the story. You know what I mean?
I didn't know the all the ins and outs of that guy.
I just knew more.
I mean, $1 million?
Yeah, because Hanny and I, you know, throughout the years, no matter what, we've always been friends and stayed in touch. And so I knew about some of the issues he had and, you know, with financial stuff. And then that wears on you personally and emotionally and all that, so... I'm glad he's doing well and got a good gig going now.
It seems like his life is a lot more drama free, and like my impression of Hanny throughout his whole racing career was he just always had drama, you know, like whether it was self inflicted or whatever. It was just there was girl problems, there's money problems, there's, you know, and I'm just thinking, man, of course you can't focus. Your life is just
a magnet.
It's a big dumpster fire, like, you know.
Hey, you know, also it shows you that another thing is that you never see the other side of the coin, especially social media and stuff today. How everybody's just ragging on people about something, and you hear the other side of the story, and it's not just that he wasn't focused or that he was just spending money. It's like he had true, legitimate problems going on.
Yeah, crazy stuff, and the lengths that those issues went. He shared a little bit with us off camera, and I mean, it's heavy stuff. So, glad to see him doing well. And I wasn't bullshitting. Watching that guy ride, it's like poetry. Like, I would say even more so than Kevin Windham or you know, like, I think my two favorite guys to watch ride a motorcycle are Ken Roczen and Josh Hansen. You know what I mean? It's just so precise and
Nobody has a style as smooth and fluid looking as Hansen.
It was a little tough at times mentally lining up with a guy where you go,
man, he's got way more natural talent than me. Because I had to do the other side, which was I've trained harder. I'm going to dig deeper. I'm going to, you know. Yeah. So I had to think of things differently. But at times it was like when you watch guys with a lot of natural ability, you're like,
I can't do that.
I wish I could have had that. Give me some of that.
All right. Well, we thank Josh Hansen for coming on and wish him the best all moving forward. I want to get into our four-wheel parts Q&A. Four-wheel parts is your one-stop shop for all things truck and off-road. So really anything that can be bolted on, mounted on, applied to an off-road truck, van, UTV, you name it, from suspension to lights to bumpers, literally anything. And they do the service themselves. Yeah, they do an awesome job. Check them out at fourwheelparts.com, the number 4wheelparts.com. Those guys are awesome. Donnie, what do we got for questions today?
What do you guys think the close racing at Paula was attributed to? Rider familiarity with the track, all the testing? It seems like rounds 2 and 3, the racing wasn't as close. So why do you think it was so close at Paula?
I think we've had close racing all year.
Yeah, I would say the same.
And I said I think a lot of it is because they haven't ripped the tracks as deep. And it's not the ripping of the track that makes everyone spread out. They have two short practices, so you don't have time, you know, and they would often kind of overwater in the morning. Part of it, I think they needed to, but I think people were just, they were going too far. They were just ripping really deep, and it was a mud bath. And I go, no, make it wet, but after each practice, just give a light coating so you kind of keep that moisture in there, not flood it in the morning and then wait for it to eventually dry out. Because what happens is one line starts forming. Now, you want to get lines for the races, but you got to get a lap time in. So what does everyone do? Everyone hammers the goat trail. And then eventually that gets rough, and then another line develops. When you don't rip it that deep, guys have the ability to come wide, square up, create different lines. There's a lot more crossover lines this year that I noticed. And I personally think they figured out we don't need to rip and water as gnarly. We just, you know, we can rip a little less and water it more frequently. But it's created more lines, which gives more opportunity for great racing, in my opinion.
Yeah, I would agree with that. They if you look back into the 90s, it's like they weren't ripping it enough. The tracks would get hard, dusty, dry. Then they'd throw water on it.
And then it was
and then
nice
it's slick and snotty. Yeah, and so they corrected, but they went a little too far. They're bringing in softer material, ripping it to, you know, the depths of the earth, and then pouring water on it.
What do
so
they
I think
do?
They found a happy medium.
What do they do to the tracks in Europe? I mean, I'm sure each...
They don't prep them between Saturday and Sunday.
At all?
None. Water. That's it.
I think if there was something, maybe like a jump face or something that's got a staircase in it or whatever, they would often go and just reshape that. But generally speaking, braking bumps, ruts, turns, they kind of stay. I think they've even softened up a little bit. I think they were very much like, when it starts, like, you know, it's GPs, it's rough, we don't groom our tracks. But I have seen in scenarios where they have had to go and do something. Usually for a safety issue. Yeah. If something's genuinely, there's challenging and then there's dangerous. And I think when you got dangerous, there's enough people that say, hey, that needs to get sorted, they'll sort it out.
And I get that on a sand track because the bumps sort of build in and it's maybe they fix a jump face or something like you're saying. But when you've got hard packed dirt, man, I don't know. It just seems to me like rip it and start over the next morning.
Yeah.
But they like it bumpy and rough, and that's just a different
setup. Guys get the, this is kind of a little bit off, but I was just thinking about the first race. Do guys get the same kind of nerves when they start the Nationals as they do when they go to Anaheim 1?
Oh, yeah.
I would think so. I mean, I know any time I lined up, especially at their first race, because maybe everyone's different, but a lot of those times at that first race, you went there to win, or you know, you were thinking championship, so I don't think it mattered the lights or the crowd so much on you. It was the racing intensity. For me, the 30-second card was the worst because it would go up and it felt like 5 minutes and my heart was just boom, 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 and the butterflies were going. And then it was funny, they would turn the card sideways. And then the minute I focused on the bike, it was like you just kind of went numb for a brief second. So I think everyone's a little bit different, but I always got very nervous every time.
And I would say maybe Anaheim's a little worse just because you have such a run of where you don't race. You know, it's several months. You might do a random
there's
race
more questions
there.
In your head as well.
Yeah.
Might be a new team, new bike, you know,
with,
new season.
With Nationals, you're only 2 weeks out of, as long as you've not been hurt, you were racing a whole series till 2 weeks ago. So you're always going to be nervous, I think.
I think I guessed myself a little more at Anaheim 1 than I would at the, whether it was Hangtown or Glen Helen opening round.
Mm. All right.
What else?
Junkman wants to know, what happens to the factory bikes at the end of the season, when the season's over?
Well, I love it when people tell me they bought a full factory bike. I'm like,
you got suckered.
Yeah. Generally speaking, they will put these bikes somewhat back to kind of standard form. They have the bells and whistles, you know, the carbon guards and the graphics and the whatever.
Exhaust.
Yeah, so they are nicer bikes. Good, you know, they freshen them up. But they are always going to take out their confidential information, things like cams, pistons, ignitions, anything that's come from factory or it's factory material that stays in there. And then those bikes, theoretically, they get sold to the public, you know, someone that wants to kind of... I think for some people, it's just the nostalgia, like, oh, I got a factory bike. And you're like, yep, I bet you did.
Yeah, good for you.
Well, except for a championship bike, right? You got to keep your bikes.
Yeah, so everyone's a little bit different. Even with Mitch, they put all stock components back in. So
in the motor.
Internally. Everything visibly is exactly how it finished, but internally, it's a stock engine, not a factory motor.
They didn't roll it out of the truck and into your house.
No. My KTM that I have... freaking tempted to pull it off the wall and give it a go through and fire her up. That's a full factory engine hanging in my shop.
Is it your super motorbike?
No, my 2003 125.
Oh, right. Hmm. And but the Yamaha almost looked like a stock bike.
It's because it pretty was close to that.
Yeah. A lot of those bikes too. They'll pull all the internals. Sometimes they'll pull all the
stuff.
It'll
be gutted.
Yeah, it's just a shell. So there's nothing inside.
The championship bikes.
Most bikes that I know of couldn't even run. You'd have to put all the internals back in.
Is that a standard deal in everybody's contract?
No.
It's not. That deal sort of, I think, came up for people when someone said, hey, I want my bike. And I know that there were situations where riders won. They said, I want my bike. And I was like, nope, it's not in the contract. So then guys were getting it put in their contract.
You'd think the factory would be happy with that. It's like, well, the guy plans on winning.
I don't know. They are happy on the championship, but I think when it comes to giving out personal information is how... Because I think the Japanese definitely are a little more secretive as far as that goes. They keep their cards close to their chest. KTM was kind of like, yeah, hang it on the wall. It'd be sick. You know, and I was like, thanks.
You're also blowing up mini bikes at the championship party.
Yeah. Well, hey, Donnie, quit living in the past, bro.
That's all I got.
All right.
Sweet.
If you've got questions for us, we will answer them. Send them over to our Twitter handle, Grant.
@W_throttle_show.
That's it.
It's been a while since I had to think about it.
She's a beauty. Or you can send them to us on Instagram as well before the shows, which is @WhiskeyThrottleShow. And we'll answer them right here on the show. So our Decal Works last call. Decal Works bringing you graphics, plastic, seat covers, garage mats, all kinds of accessories, ID products, so names, stickers, name and number for your helmet, all kinds of stuff. You can check those guys out at decalworks.com. They're the official sponsor of the Factory Red Bull KTM team. And they're giving away 5 tickets to our next live show, which is going to be July 12th. And we're holding that in Laguna Beach at the Laguna TLD Boutique. If you've never been down there, it's a really cool store right there in downtown Laguna. Super cool venue. And our guest is the icon, David Bailey. So we've had quite a few people asking us, hey, when are you going to have David Bailey on? The answer is July 12th. And that will be a live show. I think all those tickets are going to be sold through Road to Recovery. You're going to have to buy a ticket ahead of time because that is probably going to sell out for certain. We definitely have a limited number of seats we can sell there. So, check that out. We will give away 5 tickets from Decal Works. So follow us on Instagram. We'll do that through our Instagram account one way or another. And again, that is @WhiskeyThrottleShow. So don't miss that one with David Bailey. That's going to be a lot of fun. In this installment of Last Call, we got a hold of Josh's dad, former Supercross champion. What was it, 1981?
82.
82. 81, 82 Supercross champion, factory Hondas, Donnie Hansen. Donnie's... runs DHMA now, Donnie Hansen Motocross Academy, all over the country if you're looking for a good school. And, he's got some insight into Josh, and it'll be interesting here to hit him up and ask some questions. So have a listen to this conversation.
Donnie, how's it going?
It's gone. It's gone. I'm in traffic, but yeah, it's all good. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, man. Thanks for taking some time and coming on the Whiskey Throttle Show.
Yes, happy birthday.
Oh, thanks, buddy. I appreciate that very much. So we just had Josh on the show, and thought who would be better than you to chat a little bit more about him. So a couple of questions on your boy. What was Josh like as a kid growing up?
He was a handful, to say the least. Yeah, he was wound tight.
Yeah, he said it seemed like dirt bikes helped him stay out of some trouble.
Yeah, well, he found plenty of trouble with his dirt bikes, and that would prevent him to ride them at times. We missed a national, an amateur national, because they got in trouble and had to go stay up in New Mexico, Mia Dosa, New Mexico, with his grandfather, my dad and his wife, while we went to the national, Ponca City, because we were a sponsor. And so we went there and he got more trouble up there. He little kids, you know, he's riding 80 class, so he's like 12 years old or something. And one of his buddies up there ended up throwing a rock through a cop car with glass front windshield, and they ran him down, and he got in trouble and had to do some community service. So Grandpa had to take him every morning early to do his community service.
That's actually a good story right there. Typical kids, huh?
Yeah.
When did you, you know, obviously you guys got going in racing, and when did you realize that, hey, this kid's got something special, like he could go all the way?
Well, we didn't, Grant, I didn't. At
oh,
first.
Really?
I didn't at first. We were just doing it just to do it, ride and such. And then, you know, when I had my classes, before he started racing, he would sit into the class and, you know, be part of the class, and he grew up that way until he started, you know, taking it a little more seriously. And then we started putting a little money into the bike, you know, putting some better suspension on, or buying a pipe for the 60s back then, and not 65s, but
yep.
Same thing, Kawasaki's. And you know, racing local racing. And you know, I don't know, I don't remember when we decided to take it more serious and go to the amateur nationals. So, but that's what we ended up doing at some point on the 60s.
Yeah. Oh, nice. We've asked Josh, and of course he said his opinion on it, but I wanted to hear from you, maybe what, if you look at it differently. Do you think Josh maybe put too much pressure on himself at times to maybe live up to his dad's, you know, championship caliber? Because sometimes he said that he didn't feel like he fulfilled everything in racing. What's your thought on that?
Well, I don't think he really, you know, I could be wrong, but I don't think he looked at it as he had some shoes to fill, because what I'd done in the sport, I forgot the question again, Grant.
Do you think that maybe he just felt like he had some big shoes to fill with his dad being a champion?
Well,
he put too much pressure on himself.
Yeah, I don't think he put the pressure on himself, you know. He wouldn't. You know, but I could be wrong. You know, in his head, he could be putting pressure on himself that, you know, going up the line, that he's got to win, or he's got to do good or whatever. But outside of the racing, he wasn't. Well, you know what I would tell him to do, and what he did, it'd be two different things.
I mean, I think most parents have that with their kids.
Right, right. And you know, he needs to learn to be, you know, have the work ethic, you know. He has good people around him and good equipment. And what he lacked was the work ethic. But so as far as how he thought, I know how he thought. I mean, he thought that he didn't want to burn him. He wanted to be pumped for the weekend instead of working at it. And at the end of the day, you know, be tired and stuff. And now he's not pumped on the next day. But it's something you got to overcome. That the harder you work, the stronger you're going to be, the more you're going to be looking for that to be working the next day as well. And he never got into that routine. But so I don't know, as far as putting the pressure on himself, I don't know how that worked with it in his mind.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
Absolutely. No, and that's the thing. I wanted to hear from you, because we've heard from Josh. You know, he kind of said a similar thing, so that makes sense. Anyway, shifting gears, I appreciate you giving us a little insight from your perspective on Josh, but talk quickly about you. Tell us about what you're up to these days. I know you're doing a lot of schools. What's DHMA up to?
Yeah, I am traveling mostly. I don't travel as much as I used to, but I do travel from Southern California to Colorado, where we have a home in both places, and I do a lot of the camps and private small groups in Colorado, as well as here in Southern California. Just do mostly private and small groups. No camps per se, but you know, we get riders, mostly foreign riders. You know, in the winter months, they'll come over and they'll lodge with us. We'll put them up to a real nice atmosphere and nice meals and stuff and laundry, you know, we'll take care of washing the laundry and take them to track each day and have a great experience with DHMA and Southern California racing our local tracks.
Oh, nice. So you keep yourself busy.
Yeah, at times I go elsewhere too, but not like I used to. I'm probably one of the oldest schools in the country, at least the country, and so I've been all different parts of the world, you know, teaching. But anymore, there's so many instructors that, and my name don't come up as much as you know, the locals around you know, around the country that teach their parts in their neck of the woods.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, you know, I guess, Donnie, the older we get, the more of a distant memory we become. But sounds like you still got
yourself busy. The older we get, the faster we were.
Yeah, that's true too, man. That's true. Well, Donnie, thanks again for coming on the show. One of these days, we're going to have you on your show and talk about your history and legacy, and we look forward to that.
Absolutely. Me as well. I'd love to join you guys. Thanks,
yeah.
Man.
We love having you, man. We'll see you soon, Donnie. Take care.
Thanks, bud.
Cheers, bud.
All right. Well, that was Donnie Hansen, old DHMA himself. He's been a regular at our shows, too. Every live show I think he's been to.
Comes into our shop all the time. He cracks me up. He sees my dad, and he still calls him Puffy. Hey, Puffy. Want to go to the office? My dad's got a keg in his office. They end up in the office having that meeting later on in the day. But yeah, Donnie, cool guy. See him around quite a bit. It's nice.
It was shocking to hear that he doesn't basically live here, that he's in Colorado. And then we see him at the live shows all the time.
I'm thinking, how does he not live here? He's been to every single show.
He was down for that period. And then Donnie's socialite and comes in, hangs out. Like you said, and we're like, hey, Champ's just coming.
He's here for the free beer, I think he comes in and drinks his money's worth for sure.
Yeah, there you go.
Well, it's always good to have him and see him. We need to have him on the show eventually at one point. That's our show, folks. Thanks for tuning into the Whiskey Throttle Show. I want to thank PowerDot If you guys have not checked them out, get over to powerdot.com. You can type in Whiskey Throttle for that 20% off. Method Race Wheels, Troily Designs. Again, look into that Freedom Pack or that vented air gear they've got out now. It's rad stuff. Decal Works, Dunlop, Four Wheel Parts, Adidas, Pro Circuit, and Hilo Concepts, Specialized, Paleo Ranch Foods, Racer X, and Langston Motorsports. For the Whiskey Throttle Show, I'm David Pingree. With me, Grant Langston and Donnie Bale, saying thanks. We'll see you on the next show.